Fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. Behold, I am alive forevermore. I am the first and I am the last, and beside me there is no God.
I want to talk to you today about the sin of blaspheming the Word of God, or causing the Word of God to be blasphemed. We're going to go first to Titus chapter 2, verse 5. Now, Titus chapter 2 is instruction for godly women, the older women, how they should instruct the younger women. And it says in verse 5, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands. Now look at this, that the Word of God be not blasphemed. You know, a bad wife in the eyes of the world, when they see a woman that's rotten and they're professing Christians, you know what happens? Those lost people will mock this book. The Word of God will be blasphemed. They'll laugh about it. They'll mock the Bible. And it's a sin. Okay? Let's go to 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 1. We're going to see something similar here. It says, let as many servants as are under the yoke count their own masters worthy of all honor, that the name of God and His doctrine be not blasphemed. Okay? All Scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. Okay? This is where you get doctrine, the Word of God. Now, what happens when you are a poor worker as a Christian? Your boss, your master there, okay, they'll make fun of this book. They'll mock it. They'll laugh about it. And there's another way here in the modern world that this book is now being blasphemed, that this book is now being mocked by the lost world. And the cause of it is over here. The new Alexandrian versions. You say, oh, now, come on now, that's ridiculous. This is a ridiculous argument. No, it isn't, and I'm going to show you that, this philosophy here, the lost world is now picking up on it, and they're using it to blaspheme this book, the Word of God. This isn't the Word of God over here. These are counterfeit, satanic counterfeits, which, you know, I'm going to prove as we go through this thing. But I just want to say one thing here. One of the lies that's going to be said about this video here, about my video, about what I'm saying is people are going to say that I'm accusing those who defend the new versions of committing the unpardonable sin. That's not at all what I'm saying with this video. Okay, the unpardonable sin is only possible to commit when Jesus Christ is physically present on the earth. That's why he said it won't be forgiven in this world where he was, or in the world to come, the millennial kingdom. Okay. I did a sermon on that recently at our house church. Go to Sermon Audio. I'll put the link down there. Go to Sermon Audio. Listen to the unpardonable sin message if you don't know what the unpardonable sin is. Okay, this is not the same thing. All right, there are a lot of people who ignorantly attack the King James Bible because they parrot the lies that were taught to them at their seminary. Okay, now they haven't committed the unpardonable sin. You can repent of that. And I have known many Christians that, you know, men especially, they go through to be trained as preachers and they come out and they mock this book like crazy until somebody sets them straight. And then they repent of it and they end up standing up for the King James Bible after blaspheming it, causing it to be blasphemed. Okay, so it's not the unpardonable sin. Don't lie about it. All right, I'm not accusing new version people of committing the unpardonable sin. And if you say that, you're a liar. Okay? Plain and simple. But you can blaspheme this book and cause it to be blasphemed by your attacks against the King James Bible. All right? Now let me just show you the importance of this. All right, now let's take a look at 1 John chapter 5, verses 10 through 13. Some of the most important scriptures in the New Testament in terms of knowing that you are saved. Let's read. It says here, he that believeth on the Son of God hath the witness in himself. He that believeth not God hath made him a liar, because he believeth not the record that God gave of his Son. And this is the record, that God hath given to us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He that hath the Son hath life, And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. So what is this record? Okay. Is it something that you feel? Is it some kind of a special burning in the bosom, you know, as the Mormons teach? What is the record that you are saved? Verse 13. These things have I written unto you that believe on the name of the Son of God, that ye may know that ye have eternal life, and that ye may believe on the name of the Son of God. Now you see, the way a Christian can prove that they are saved and the way a Christian can lead others to Jesus Christ is not by feelings. It's not by oral tradition. It's by written scripture. And there is no set of holy scriptures, holy writings, anything. There's no other ancient book out there that even comes close to the Bible in terms of ancient manuscripts and work that has been done for thousands of years to preserve this book. No other scriptures can claim the ancient history that the King James Bible does. Okay? And we have ancient witnesses, thousands and thousands and thousands of manuscripts, which, by the way, the New Testament manuscripts, over 95% line up with this King James Bible. Okay? I have that in other videos. But my point is, this right here is your written record of how you are saved. Somebody says, I need proof that you're saved. Right there. Open it up and you can show them how I know I'm saved and how that they can know that they are saved. And let me just show you something else to kind of illustrate this point. Right here is the title to my pickup truck. Now let's say I'm driving down the road sometime and I get pulled over by a police officer for some reason. And he says, license and registration, please. Oh, I don't have that. Well, is this your truck? Well, I think so. I feel it is. Well, do you have a owner's card, registration? Do you have the title? Well, no, I don't have a title. And the police officer says, well, then how do you know that this is your truck? Well, I feel good about it. I feel it's my truck. Guess where I'm going to be going? I'm going to get to see the inside of a police station and probably even the inside of a jail. You know, yeah, that's the way it is. Okay, this is a legally binding document. This is proof right here that I own my pickup truck. All right, proof, written proof. Now, who came up with this system? God did. Written proof right here. The greatest book of all time. And I don't mean the Bible as a generic term for any of 200 different versions. I mean, the King James Bible is the greatest book ever. Okay, that is a scientifically provable fact. It is the greatest book. It has been printed more than any book in history. It has been distributed more than any book in history. I mean, how many books retain their popularity after 400 years? Okay, we're almost at 400 years with this King James Bible, and it's still one of the most popular, best-selling books on the market. Okay? It's not just another book. All right? It's just ridiculous, these people that come up with these attacks on the King James Bible. But I want to show you some video clips here in this study. I want to show you some things here where the lost world is mocking this book. They're blaspheming the Word of God because of all these ridiculous new versions. I'm going to prove it to you in this video, and I'm going to actually show you that it's a lot worse than most people realize. So let's start out here. This is an older debate between Dr. Ken Hovind and Dr. Pigliucci, I guess his name is, an Italian evolutionist. I'll refrain myself from giving you my opinion of the man. But listen to what Dr. Pigliucci says in this debate about the Bible.
The Bible has lots of scientific statements. It's not a science book, but when it deals with science, it's right.
Which version of it? Of course. Which version of it? Which version of it? Which version of it?
Isn't that interesting? Oh, the Bible says this. Which one? You see, it is a rather ridiculous religion that has, I don't even know the number right now, I've lost track, over 100 versions of their holy book, and they all contradict one another. I mean, that if that's true, that they're all editions of God's holy word, then we have a very confused God. Okay? But let me just show you the street application of this. Okay, we saw it there among the lost world of evolutionists that they're teaching their students. They laugh at this book because of the multiple new versions that have come out to make this book look bad. But let's go to the street now. We're going to see some street ministry, and we're going to see this thing. So check this video clip out.
Where in the Bible says, can you find in the Bible where it says, when Jesus says, I am God, worship me?
Well, in the Bible, when people...
I'll give you $100 in any Bible, there's 80 of them. If you find me...
Okay.
There's 80 Bibles, but there's only one for
us. Allah isn't like that either.
Why is there more than one Bible?
Allah isn't like that either.
Why is there more than one Bible?
Allah isn't like that either.
Why is there more than one Bible?
Allah isn't like that either.
Why is there more than one Bible?
Which one of the 80 versions is God's Word? That's a good question, actually. Very good question. Now, how can you answer him if you are for the new versions? How do you answer a man like that, a young man like that, that's making an attack, that's blaspheming the Word of God, that's mocking this book right here? How do you answer him? Well, now see, if it was me that was asked that question, I can answer him no problem. I'll say, well, this one right here, the King James Bible is God's perfect word for the English-speaking people. All the others are counterfeits, okay? Satan came in and he made all these other versions as counterfeits of the one true Bible. And by the way, read the preface in all the new versions. They all attack this book. Okay? Yes, there is a satanic conspiracy against the King James Bible. It's been proven over and over and over again. And we're just going to keep proving it until the Lord takes us out of here. So that's the way it's going to be. But now, if you're for these new versions, how can you answer a young Muslim that comes to you and says, which of the 80 versions is God's word? Well, you're forced to do one of two things. Number one, you can lie to him and you can say, all the Bibles say the same thing. All the translations, all of these 80 plus over 100 actually, all of them say the same thing. Now, a lost person can pick that apart like that. All right? They don't say the same thing. That's a lie. A total lie. And that's what most modern Christians will say to the lost world when they are asked this question. That all the new versions say the same thing. No, they don't. No, they do not. Okay? They're not even from the same Greek text. Not even from the same part of the world. This over here is from Egypt. This is from Antioch. This has over 95% of extant Greek manuscripts support this text. Less than 5% over here. No, they're not the same, okay? So if you're a new versionist, you have to lie to the lost world out on the street. If you're a King James Bible believer, King James onlyism, you know, you can tell the truth. You see the problem? But then the other option, I said there were two options. Number one is you can lie to the guy and say all the versions say the same thing, which is a lie, and of course he can disprove you very easily. But the second option is to say, well, you see, all of the versions are just translations, and we don't really have any that are perfect, and that none of them are really God's Word. They're all just man-made books, which is really what the new versionists believe in their minds. Okay? That's what they believe. Do you think a young Muslim is going to convert to Christianity if he's told that there is no perfect Bible? Absolutely ridiculous. You see, the Bible prophesies, and I'm going to get into this a little bit more later, but the Bible prophesies that there would come a great falling away. And you want to know why? Right there. There's no final authority anymore. We have contradicting versions, and you pick the one that you prefer. Absolutely ridiculous. Now, how did this new version philosophy enter into Christianity? Well, I hate to tell you, but it came in through the seminaries. Okay, the educated Christians. All right, and for many years, the educateds have mocked this comic book by Jack Chick. This comic book is Sabotage, and it deals with, you go into here, it deals with a young man who goes off to seminary, and his college professor, his Bible college professor, tells him that the Bible is a man-made book and it's not perfect. And it destroys his faith, and the young man goes crazy, and he burns a cemetery, burns a seminary down, and you know, he smashes the Bible into the professor's face and everything else, and people, boy, that's ridiculous. What an over-exaggerated story. Oh, really? Well, I'm going to show you some personal testimony here from professing Christians, who I don't believe were ever saved, but professing Christians that went off to their Bible seminaries because they felt a call to be in ministry, and they had their faith destroyed in this book, in the Word of God. They had their faith destroyed in it because of the seminaries, because of the Alexandrian school of thought. And as a result, they eventually left Christianity altogether and are now Muslims. So let me show you some clips here from the first man, and then we'll go on. I'll show you another one. Check this out.
I grew up in a small rural community in Kansas where the church was the center of community life. We attended the local Methodist church, and throughout my childhood, I was very actively involved in collecting my perfect attendance pens from Sunday school, mm-hmm. my awards for memorizing biblical verses, etc. And so by the time I reached junior high school, I was already considering the ministry as a personal calling. And at age 17, I entered Harvard College as an undergraduate with a philosophy major, which was gearing towards seminary. Mm-hmm. And continued on in that direction. In 1969, I received my license to preach mm-hmm. from the United Methodist Church. In 1971, graduated as an undergraduate and entered Harvard Divinity School, which is a three-year program leading to a degree in Master of Divinity. In 1972, I was ordained a deacon in the United Methodist Church, and in 1974, I graduated with a Master of Divinity from Harvard Divinity School. Mm-hmm. Spent that summer as an interim minister in two rural parishes in Kansas. But in the fall of 1974, I left the ministry, mm-hmm. or at least left the parish ministry. I was still an ordained minister, but never again would I fill a pulpit after the fall of 1974. Basically, it's one of the ironies of life that the churches often take the most promising of their young ministers and they send them to really good seminaries. And in those really good seminaries, such as the one I was fortunate enough to attend, you are systematically exposed to the oldest existing texts of how the Bible actually once read. You're exposed to the changes that were made in those texts, when those changes took place, why those changes took place, where mm-hmm. those changes took place. So once you receive that knowledge, and those changes, by the way, raise serious, serious questions mm-hmm. about such fundamental Christian doctrines as the Trinity, the Sonship of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, the crucifixion event, and the doctrine of atonement and the blood. All of these come into serious question when you look at the oldest manuscripts that we have of what the Bible once said. So that was one consideration. But these are the two fundamental reasons why I left the Christian ministry. It really boiled down to an issue of personal integrity. Mm-hmm. You know, how could I stand behind the pulpit on Sunday morning and preach a sermon that I knew was at variance with the actual taproot of Christianity. Of course, if I stood behind the pulpit on Sunday morning and preached what I had been taught in seminary, I'd be looking for a new job within a week.
Yeah.
So this conflict existed. And as a result, to preserve my personal integrity, I left the active ministry and pursued graduate school in clinical psychology. And by the way, approximately half of my graduating class from Harvard Divinity School walked away from the parish ministry upon graduation. So I wasn't the only one.
Is this kind of like the, have you heard of Bart Arum?
Yes, yes.
Kind of people also who have gotten engrossed and really started to go deeper into studying the original text, and many of them, they come to the conclusion that you have, that, you know, a lot of this is not making sense, it doesn't fit.
Sure, sure, you know, the biblical scholar you mentioned is a good example of that, but there are many others as well.
Can you name a few that some people who are out there, the academics, who they recognize these people, these names?
Well, Bart Ehrman is certainly one. But it's really almost any good biblical scholar knows. I mean, all you have to do is pick up a good Bible commentary, such as the Interpreter's Bible Commentary, and begin reading it.
Yeah.
And you'll be exposed in the process to, wait a minute, this text originally read this way, and this was inserted into the text around the year 380 in Spain. This sort of information's there. It's available to the public, but they have to really go out and study in order to find it.
That's the thing. How many actually want to take the time to investigate instead of just blindly going along with what everyone else is going along with?
Yeah, and it does take a great deal of time to try and do it on your own.
Uh-huh.
You see, the thing that he mentioned there, the earliest manuscripts and things, and a lot of these, this school of thought, that's over here. Vaticanus and Sinaiticus and all the papyrus fragments and everything else, the Alexandrian manuscripts, they are earliest because no Christian ever messed with them. Okay? That's why there are such old copies. They are held by the Roman Catholic Church. Even today, the Vaticanus manuscript is held in the care of the Vatican. All right? And read the Nestle's 27th edition. Look at my other videos. Look at the Real Bible Version Issue Exposed. I prove all of it. I show it. The new versions are based on this Nestle's text, and you read the Nestle's text, and it says that it was made under the supervision of the Vatican, and there was a Jesuit cardinal, Carlo Martini, that sat on the translation team of the Nestle's text. Okay? This is Roman Catholic over here. You say, which ones? All Bibles produced since 1881 are Roman Catholic, or they rely on this, or will make reference to this. The New King James Version blends Receptus and Nestle's readings. Okay, the New King James Version isn't any good either. You say, which one is good? Right here, King James Bible. But at least I will say one thing for this older man here that's now a Muslim or whatever. He said that he couldn't, in good conscience, stand up there and preach from a book that he knew was a lie. Now, I respect that at least. At least he's honest. You see, most of the preachers up and down this country right now, they are taught Alexandrian philosophy where the Bible's not perfect, it's just a man-made book, and then what are they doing in the pulpit? See, it's a living. It's money. They make a lot of money at it, okay? But if you go to these people, go to your local pastor, okay? Now, if you're in an independent Bible-believing Baptist church, chances are he's probably going to believe the book, this book. But if you're in another type of church, go to him and ask him if this book is perfect. Ask him if the Bible that he preaches from is perfect. Check it out, okay? He said, oh, I don't believe in this conspiracy stuff, this Bible version conspiracy thing. Okay, ask your pastor. If your pastor has gone through this school of philosophy, he'll tell you about it. Well, no, you know, no translation is inspired. We need to watch out for King James onlyism. Ask him. But at least that older man there, the man that you just saw in the video, at least he was honest enough to say that he could not in good conscience stand in a pulpit and preach from a book that he didn't believe in. Okay? And I have more respect for somebody like that than these fake preachers out there in America today who stand up in the pulpit and preach out of books that they don't believe in. Okay, that's wickedness. Just incredible. But let's go on to the next young man who lost his faith, had his faith in God's word destroyed by his seminary education, and now he is a Muslim. And you aren't going to believe where this guy was educated at. Check this one out.
So I was in a frenzy, and I started telling my friend, and he realized that I was in a Christian crisis, as to say. You know, I was in real crisis. So he took me to back to the scholars at Bob Jones, and he also got me in touch with some Bible scholars at the Moody Institute in Chicago, which is one of the biggest evangelical schools in this country, the Moody Institute, which is where I plan to perhaps do my graduate studies after Bob Jones. And they came together and they had, you know, an intervention, as to say, you know, they tried putting, they began to think, because I started to believe that this book cannot be from God. It cannot be from God, because there's too much in it that does not make sense. And then I also started to notice the contradictions of the texts. Started reading the text, I started to realize that not only are there contradictions in what the text says, which there are thousands of them, and for sake of time, there's no need to go through them. If you want to know them, there are many books out there that will show you them. Books written by non-Muslims, to say. I ended up talking to one guy at Bob Jones University, and I don't want to give out his name because he will probably not be very happy with me saying that he is the person who wrecked my faith in Christianity. And he would not be very pleased if I were to give out his name and accredit that to him, because he's probably still a professor at Bob Jones. But he sat me down and he said, "You know what, Brother Joshua? You're seeing all these things that are happening, you know, mistakes, things that don't make sense, you know, things that don't look right." And he said, "You're going to see it, and you're going to continue to see it if you continue to read this book." He said, "Because this book was written by man's hands. And anything that has been touched by man's hands will have fingerprints still left on it." He said, "So what happened was, when all these things you see wrong, is that somebody probably just made a mistake." He said, the copy of the copy of the copy, the scribe who copied this person, who person, this, so on and so forth, probably one of them made a mistake, and somebody copied his mistake and made his own mistake, and then that person compounded the other person's mistake, and maybe somebody came back and corrected one person's mistake and then added his own. He said, "So that's probably what happened, and you have the final product of all of that." And that just, I had to sit down and actually take that for a second, because I was fighting inside myself to try to keep this book at the status that it has always been in my home, the inerrant Word of God. This is how I was taught, inerrant Word of God without error, revealed by divine inspiration through men and transcribed onto paper. And I began to realize that this was not the case. So needless to say, and for the sake of time, I left Christianity altogether.
The great Bob Jones University has destroyed thousands of Christian young men. I've talked to a couple of them myself, so don't tell me I don't know what I'm talking about. I've talked to them. I've heard the personal experiences. I talked to a pastor of a Baptist church the one time who said that he still has his old King James Bible that he took with him when he went to Bob Jones University, and when he came out, when he graduated, that thing was filled with notes saying, "This verse shouldn't be in there, that word is mistranslated, this verse shouldn't be there, this chapter shouldn't be there, this is actually in question, this is probably added." And some older Christian man came to him and got a hold of him and showed him the Bible version issue and told him, "If you want any kind of spiritual power at all in your life, you are going to have to read and believe that King James Bible." And he showed him the error of the Alexandrian school of thought, and praise God, he quit this school of thought over here. And I knew another guy, I actually was able to teach the Bible version issue at a church at one point, and there was another graduate of Bob Jones University there, and he was rolling his eyes and mad and huffing and puffing the whole way through the thing for about, for about a half hour. And then when the facts really started getting through to him, he started realizing, uh-oh, I've been deceived. And I had a whole stack of books there on the Bible version issue, some of these back here. And he said, "Can I borrow those, please?" And that guy took them home. He read all those books in like a week, you know, converted over to being a at least understanding that this is wrong, okay? And there are many, many, many more preachers that I have heard of that come out of Bob Jones University attacking and denying this book, and yet they preach from it. See, you can make a living from preaching from it. Just don't believe it. You know, that's Ruckmanism. You know, when you believe it. Absolutely ridiculous. But that's what happens when you are educated against the King James Bible. And let me just say something else here before I continue. One of the reasons why these two men have converted over to Islam is because Islam is smart enough to have one book, the Quran. Okay, and this is not a holy book, okay? This is an unholy book. A lot of ridiculous nonsense in here, which I'll show you in just a minute or two. But the point is, they aren't going to have multiple versions. A version for the feminists. Yeah, right. among Islam, they'll have a feminist Bible. I don't think so. Okay? And of course, I don't defend the way they treat women and everything, obviously, is ridiculous. But the point is, at least they're smart enough to only have one English translation. Just incredible. But if you want to find out more on Islam and how it is just such a ridiculous system, how Muhammad was a pervert, how he was, you know, just horrible things that guy did. And some of the things he taught were just incredible. I mean, just ridiculous. Right here, Muhammad's Believe It or Not by Abdullah Aziz. And you can actually read things in here. It's illustrated, you know, it's comic book format. But you read it, and you think, there's no way. And I actually went and I got a copy of the Quran so I could look up some of this stuff, and you know, because I thought, there's no way that they actually would teach that. But then you actually get the thing and you read it and you go, wow, they actually do teach that. So, very, very good. Get a copy of that. I'll give links for this down in the description area. But now let's move on to the next section. One more thing on this subject of Islam and their discussion now. They're starting to pick up on this whole new version thing over here. There's a great article. I'm going to give a link to it down in the description area. And you can go there and you can read it. And you can see how a lot of the Muslims are now starting to pick up the writings of Kurt Aland and some of these guys, Bruce Metzger, these destructive Bible critics. And the Muslims are starting to pick up on those readings now, or there's writings, and they're saying, look, these great Christian scholars are actually saying that the Bible's imperfect, that the Bible's just a man-made book, and that only the original writings, only the original autographs were the divinely inspired Word of God. The Islamic world is now picking up on that and using it against Christianity and using it to blaspheme the Word of God. I can't cover this whole thing in this video, but you can go there and you can read all the details of how the Islamic world is now attacking Christianity because of the new versions. So make sure to read the article. All right, one of the most common practices in criminology, when there's a crime committed and you go there as a detective or whatever and you want to solve this crime, you find somebody murdered or something and you want to find out who did it, okay, is you have to look at motive. That's one of the most important things. Who would have benefited from this crime? Now, let's be open-minded here. If you're a new versionist, just go along with it for a minute. I know that's hard for you to do, but who would benefit from replacing this book? Okay, for a long time, this was the only Bible used by professing Christianity. Okay. And there were, you know, the Douay Rheims was available actually before the King James Version, the Douay Rheims came out. But for a couple hundred years, this was the book. And if you look at Christianity, the strength of Christianity in those years, there was no country on the planet that didn't have Christian missionaries going into it. And they were all carrying King James Bibles. Okay? The greatest works ever completed for the Lord were all done with this book. Okay, and everything's been falling apart ever since this garbage over here came out. So let's just say for a minute that there was a crime committed, that this book here was attacked by this over here. Now, who would benefit from that? Who could possibly be behind these new versions? Well, if you actually watch my Real Bible Version Issue Exposed video. It's available here on YouTube. Go to my channel and go to the playlist, and you can watch the whole thing. Won't cost you a cent. If you watch it, I kind of prove, not kind of, I do prove who is behind the new versions. I made reference to it earlier. But I'm going to show you, from their own writings, the writings of Jesuit fathers of the Catholic Church. I'm going to show you from their own writings exactly who benefits from this over here. So let's take a look at this. Okay, here we have The Church Teaches, Documents of the Church in English Translation by Jesuit Fathers of St. Mary's College. All right, let me zoom in here. We're going to go to page 59. Let me zoom in a little bit more so you can really kind of make this out. This is important to get. The place of textual criticism, which I've been discussing. In our times, it is praiseworthy to use the art known as textual criticism in editing secular writings, and this art finds its most proper use when exercised on the sacred writings, for these writings deserve the respect due to the divine word. The purpose of this act is to restore the original text as perfectly as possible, to remove the corruptions which the fallibility of copyists has caused, and as far as it can, to do away with the glosses and omissions, the inversions and repetitions of words, and all the other kinds of mistakes that invariably slip into texts handed down through many centuries. And all should well realize that this lengthy task is necessary to understand correctly the divinely inspired texts. This task is demanded of us by love, since we should certainly be grateful to the providence of God, who from his throne of majesty has given these writings to his children. Now I'm going to show you another reason here. Here on page 93 it says, Christ's church is not a society of equals, as if all the faithful in it had the same rights, but it is a society in which not all are equal. Now of course you see the hypocrisy right away of that statement about textual criticism, that they are, you know, really trying to find and restore the original writings and stuff. Yeah, why would they use this minority text if they're concerned about restoring and really, you know, let's really look at the different Greek texts and everything? Yeah, they're using the poorest text that is out there. Okay, less than 5% of the manuscripts. You want to find the real ones, you go over here to the Receptus readings. Okay, very poor argument. Christ's church is not a society of equals. You see, right there is the main motivation for this right here, Alexandrian philosophy. It sets up a multiple-tiered religious system. You see, you have the educated, the ones that can interpret the original Greek. You know, what? Oh, this manuscript here and this papyrus fragment there and we don't really know for sure, and you have to come to me to know what the Bible really says and really teaches. See, it sets up that system. This is Roman Catholicism over here. It's that system. For over 1,000 years, the Roman Catholic Church only had the Latin Vulgate, Jerome's Latin Vulgate, okay? And they controlled the laity with it. Most of the people throughout the Dark Ages couldn't read. And why? Because the Catholic Church could control them. You know what the greatest fear of Roman Catholicism is? Right there. This King James Bible, again, scientifically proven fact, this King James Bible has caused more damage to Roman Catholicism than any war or any economic hard times or anything. Okay? And they even talked about it in the introduction. They talked about that this will give such a blow to that man of sin as shall not be recovered. Okay, the man of sin they were referring to was the Pope. All right, the translators knew that. This is the greatest threat to Roman Catholicism. That's why they have introduced all of these perversions. And as I said, you can trace it back. It's not a conspiracy theory. It's not some kind of an unproven, whimsical notion that I had one night or something. It's proven. Okay, look at your footnotes in your new versions. It talks about the two oldest manuscripts, Vaticanus and Sinaiticus. It's proven. It goes back to the Catholic Church. Okay, the Catholic Church promotes the new versions. It's right there. The NIV was partly translated at a Catholic university. All this was proven in my Real Bible Version Issue Exposed videos. I can't help you if you will not accept this truth. There's not much I can do for you. Okay? But now there are two reasons, okay, why the Catholic Church, and I will say, they'll talk about the sacred scriptures. Oh, the sacred scriptures and things like that. So don't be fooled over here when people that profess, you know, they defend the new versions. They'll be very reverent with the new versions many times. They'll talk about them being the sacred, the holy word of God and everything. Yeah, just like the Catholics do. But tradition comes in there and plays a part. But there are two reasons why the Catholic Church does not want a final authority in the hands of the common man. Number one, this over here leaves loopholes to sin, to get away with it. You see, this one says, you know, this you shouldn't do this. This one says you should. This one says you shouldn't. This one says you should. So who's to really say for sure? See, you go along and you prefer one Bible over another. Well, this verse here I prefer out of the NIV. I prefer this one out of the New King James. I prefer this one out of the Reader's Digest Bible. I prefer that one out of the New Revised Standard Version. See, it leaves a loophole. You are your own God at that point. Okay? There is no thus saith the Lord. It's thus saith my preferences. I do what feels right. I go with the version that most appeals to me. See, that's the number one problem. Okay, but secondly, which I referred to a little bit earlier, a perfect King James Bible, a perfect book that can be called God's Word, that puts us all on the same level, doesn't it? The man up in the pulpit there, or the priest, or the bishop, or the pope, can be judged by the common man down there without even a high school education. And there are many great men of God that didn't even have a high school education, much less a Bible college education, grade school education. D.L. Moody, Billy Sunday. Both men went on to great works for the Lord. Why? Because of a book. And common men have used this book. And isn't it interesting that Jesus Christ was heard most by common men? And it's the common man today that uses and believes this book. Isn't that interesting? You ought to read 1 Corinthians chapter 1 sometime too, by the way, to see what the Lord thinks about educated, powerful, influential people as opposed to the poor people. And look too in the Gospels where Jesus talks about preaching to the poor. Okay? And also in the book of Acts. Time and time and time again, they're going to the poor. They're going to the simple. They're not going to the elite. All right? But now I just want to go over something else here. There were three groups of men that Jesus had trouble with the whole time down here. Three groups. Okay, who were they? Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes. And then, of course, there were other ones too. The Herodians, you know, and the lawyers and things. I realize that. But the three main groups that Jesus went after, that they were always on him, always attacking him, always trying to make him look bad, always asking him questions. That's another thing. Pharisees, Sadducees, scribes. But now, what are the modern manifestations of Pharisees, Sadducees, and scribes? Oftentimes, the liberal professing Christian will try to put the title Pharisee on a Bible believer. Okay, I'm going to show you that that's not true. We're going to go first to Mark chapter 7, verses 1 through 3. Here we read, "Then came together unto him the Pharisees and certain of the scribes which came from Jerusalem. And when they saw some of his disciples eat bread with defiled, that is to say, with unwashed hands, they found fault. For the Pharisees and all the Jews, except they wash their hands oft, eat not, holding the tradition of the elders." Notice it was not the word of God. Okay, they didn't say, you know what it says back in the book of Exodus, or it says back in the book of Leviticus. They didn't say it. The tradition of the elders. They held tradition above the word of God. Let's continue on. Verse 5. Then the Pharisees and scribes asked him, why walk not thy disciples according to the tradition of the elders, but eat bread with unwashed hands? He answered and said unto them, well hath Esaias prophesied of you hypocrites, as it is written, this people honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Howbeit in vain do they worship me, teaching for doctrines the commandments of men. For laying aside the commandment of God, ye hold the tradition of men, as the washing of pots and cups, and many other such like things ye do. And he said unto them, full well ye reject the commandment of God, that ye may keep your own tradition. Okay, now look down at verse 13. It says, making the word of God of none effect through your tradition, which ye have delivered, and many such like things do ye. You see, a Pharisee is somebody that holds traditions above the word of God. So who would be your modern manifestation of a Pharisee? Catholics. And you can read Catholic writings. They will talk about sacred tradition having equal authority to that of sacred scripture. That's the group. That's your modern day Pharisee. And by the way, there are many people within professing Christianity which also hold traditions above the authority of Scripture. There's a lot of them out there. Okay, I live in an area where it's very prevalent. All right, we have a lot of people around here, Amish in particular, that hold the traditions of the elders. That's what they even call them, the men of the church, the elders and things, the bishop. They hold their traditions above that of Scripture. Okay? And a lot of them are lost. You say, oh, now, come on. My family's been here, goes back in this area. We go back before a lot of the Amish got here. Okay, I was raised around them. You're not going to tell me things about the Amish. Okay, I know what's going on with the Amish. What? They hold their traditions above the Word of God, just like Catholics do. You say, well, then King James Bible, King James only people are Pharisees. No, we're not. We hold the Scriptures in the highest regard. And we break down traditions that don't line up with Scripture. If there are traditions, and you say, well, what about King James onlyism? Show me through church history where they were using multiple versions. That didn't even show up. Show me where the philosophies and the statements that the New Version Christians, show me in Scripture where that was at. Well, a better translation would be, well, no translation is inspired. Well, actually, the Greek word there really does mean, show me it. This thing only showed up here since this whole philosophy became popularized by Westcott and Hort. Okay? Before that, it wasn't around. Before that, people held to the authority of one book. Okay? And, oh, it wasn't the King James Bible. Yeah, I know that. Obviously. Okay, the King James Bible was translated 1611. What did they have before that? Well, there were many other translations back then. Okay, but they came from the right type of manuscripts and from the right type of philosophy. Okay, many of the early Christians, the Waldensians, dating back to the first century, they had their own Bible. Okay, they weren't walking around with multiple versions and making a version to appease the feminists and making a version to appease the youth and one to appease the elderly and things like that. They weren't doing that. Okay? You have no argument if you're a new versionist. But let's look at the second group, the Sadducees. Now, what did they deny? Mark chapter 12, verse 18 says, then come unto him the Sadducees, which say there is no resurrection, and they asked him, saying. Okay, so who do you have as the Sadducees? Well, that would be your modern liberal professing Christian. People that deny miracles, people that deny heaven, people that deny resurrection. Okay, another part it says about that they denied, the Sadducees also denied the spirit and angels. That's your modern day liberal, ecumenical type, World Council of Churches, Federal Council of Christian Churches, that type of people. Those are the ones that are your Sadducees. Okay? And guess who they attack, by the way? They attack Bible believers. Fundamentalists, you know, as they say. But I'm going to show you a clip here from the Real Bible Version Issue Exposed. I'm going to show you a clip of Westcott, who was one of the fathers of this school of thought over here. I'm going to show you a clip to prove that he was a Sadducee. Here it is. On page 52, Westcott said, "I never read an account of a miracle, but I seem instinctively to feel its improbability and discover some want of evidence in the account of it." In volume 2, page 49, Westcott gives his views on heaven. He writes, "It saves us from the error of connecting the presence of Christ's glorified humanity with place. Heaven is a state and not a place." On page 394, Westcott states, "If Tennyson's idea of heaven was true, that heaven is the ministry of soul to soul, we may reasonably hope by patient, resolute, faithful, united endeavor to find heaven about us here, the glory of our earthly life." Now, is there any doubt that Westcott, Brooke Foss Westcott, was a Sadducee, not believing in heaven? Well, I can tell you, I know why he didn't believe in heaven. It's because he's not going there, and he didn't go there. Okay? Westcott and Hort were lost. And by the way, the clips in that video that I just showed you there were photoscanned pages from their books. Okay? They weren't my writings. They were their writings. Well, let's continue on. What about the third group, the scribes? Okay, who are the scribes? Well, those are your modern-day textual critics. Over here. Mark chapter 1, verse 21 and 22 says, "And they went into Capernaum, and straightway on the Sabbath day he entered into the synagogue and taught. And they were astonished at his doctrine, for he taught them as one that had authority, and not as the scribes." You see, scribes teach doubt. They don't say, "Thus saith the Lord, this is God's perfect book, don't question it." Uh-uh, they don't do that. They say, "A better rendering would be, some authorities say," see, over here, "we need a better translation." You read the preface to the NIV sometime, by the way, and they say, there's a sense in which the work of translation is never wholly finished, I think they say. In other words, we don't have it right, it's not perfect, and it'll never be perfect. You're going to just have to keep buying more and more and more translations, you know. That's good money. Make good money that way. And they're coming out with a new NIV, as I've said in other videos, the 2011 NIV, you know. Ironic that they would pick the 400th anniversary of God's pure word. Okay? Satanic counterfeit, that's all it is. But I just want to show you here, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 3 through 5. I'm going to show you the Bible actually describes this crowd right here. Okay, the scribes. Look at this. Verse 3. "If any man teach otherwise and consent not to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and to the doctrine which is according to godliness, he is proud, knowing nothing." Let me just stop there for a second. "Oh, I know Dr. So-and-so over here. He's had years of seminary training and teaching, and he's got 5 earned degrees. He knows nothing." If you don't consent to wholesome words, even the words of our Lord Jesus Christ, and I'm going to talk about this more in just a couple minutes here, you know nothing. Your education means absolutely nothing. If you can't produce a perfect standard, if it's just your preferences, then your education means nothing. Let's continue. Verse 4. "He is proud, knowing nothing, but doting about questions and strifes of words, whereof cometh envy, strife, railings, evil surmisings, perverse disputings of men of corrupt minds and destitute of the truth, supposing that gain is godliness. From such withdraw thyself." Now you say, well, you're using the same argument. We can use the same arguments on you King James only people because you're attacking the Word of God over here. Wrong. Okay? I attack counterfeits, which are not the Word of God, and I offer a perfect replacement. I don't tell you, it's up to you. Whatever you prefer. I don't do that. I'm never going to point to you as being the final authority, and I'll never point to myself as being the final authority. I would be a rotten final authority. Okay? And by the way, that's one of the ways that us Bible believers can spot the satanic deception over here and the satanic deception that you new versionists proclaim. Because you try to put it back to our own preferences. And those of us that have been saved for a while know what that means. We know what happens when we rely on our own preferences as standards of truth. Okay? It leads to sin. When you rely on your own preferences, on your own feelings, on your own thoughts, it always ends in sin every single time. You have to be submissive to something. And if there is no perfect Bible, then we're lost. Then we have a problem, a very serious problem. We need to have a perfect standard to submit to, not our own feelings and our own preferences. Okay? And that's why I am so much against, and I will fight until the day I die, by God's grace, I'm going to continue fighting this garbage right here because I know the philosophy. All right? It's not our preferences and your preferences. Okay? It's Satanism over here. It's no authority at all. The King James Bible is not perfect, and neither is any other version. That's what the New Version philosophy is about. That's not the philosophy of a King James Bible believer. A King James Bible believer says, perfect, in error. Okay? These ones are not perfect. This one is. But, you know, if I would have more sympathy if somebody said, no, the King James Bible is not perfect, but the NIV is God's perfect, inspired word. But yet, somehow, I've never met anybody that believes that way. You get this philosophy over here, somebody that's using one of these new versions, and they will say, well, you know, I think that there might be a perfect Bible, but you know, it's certainly not the NIV. It's not the one I use here, you know. See? And why is it that the people over here will use multiple versions? I've never met anybody who's NIV only. Isn't that weird? The only group of only believers are King James only people. Just incredible. Just want to make another point here before we continue on. Not much more here in the study, but I just want to make another point. When you, as a professing Christian, okay, and I don't know whether some of these New Version people that attack the King James Bible, I don't know whether you're saved or not. I honestly think that a lot of you aren't. I think a lot of you are lost because if the Holy Ghost was within you, you would not be attacking God's perfect word, okay? You would not be saying that there is no perfect standard. It's up to you to prefer which one you want. Okay? The Holy Ghost is not going to have you say that. Now, maybe you've quenched the Spirit. Maybe you're just, you know, walking in your own lusts and whatever and deceived and you're just a miserable, rotten example of a Christian. Maybe that's possible, but I'm going to treat you like you're lost. I'm sorry. Hey, if at the judgment seat of Christ, if I was wrong, well, I'll just say, hey, I'm sorry about that. You sure had me deceived. But what if I was right? What if I was right and these people that attack the King James Bible, I didn't say that use the new versions. There are a lot of people that use the new versions. I used an NIV for 15 years before I found out the truth. Okay? I didn't know. But I'm talking about those of these people out there that know about the Bible version issue and turn on God's preserved word, this book here, and attack it. I doubt that you're saved. Okay? Sorry, that's just the way I feel. But let me just say this. If you have made it your purpose to come here to YouTube and to post videos against the King James Bible and offer no perfect substitute and just tell people it's up to you to prefer one or the other. And isn't it weird too, by the way, how they'll say the King James Bible is an error here, 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 and here, and here, and here, and here, and they attack the King James Bible and then you turn around and you say, well, it's not God's word then? Well, you know, you can still use it. You can prefer it. You can... If it's not God's word, then ditch it. Throw it out. Give me something to replace it with. But they never do. the best question that you can ask any of these New Version people, the very best question is, where can I get a copy of God's perfect written word? Where can I get one? They will never answer it. They will tell you any of them work. No, doesn't work that way. Okay, but let me just say this. When you post videos attacking this book, you give ammunition, you give arguments to the lost world to blaspheme the Word of God. You give them things that they can use that will convince them that there is no perfect Bible, and they'll go to hell for all of eternity because of the videos that you're posting. And don't even think about trying to turn that back on me, because it doesn't work. Okay? I'm saying these are an error, this is perfect. You are saying this is an error, these are an error. Everything's an error. Okay? You are destroying final authority. I'm defending final authority. We're not on the same level. No, we're not. Next, I want to show you an example of a simple Bible-believing faith. The kind of people that God will use and that God will bless. Let me just show you what this is all about. All right, here I have a copy of the second book in the Foxfire series. A book, a series of books about people, older people living out in the hills. The Appalachian Mountains, or Appalachian, however you want to say it. And I'm going to show you an example of what simple faith in the Word of God is all about. Here we read this guy, his name's Happy, and he says, "The trouble today," they write as they speak down south, you know, out in the hills, "the trouble today is churches ain't like they used to be." This was written in 1970, by the way. These interviews were conducted in the late 60s, early 70s, when the new versions were really starting to come out, the RSV and the New American Standard Version. He says here, "The trouble today is churches ain't like they used to be. I've heard preachers get up in the pulpit and preach, and I didn't believe a word they as a telling. Yeah, and I had some to get up and preach, and they preach the Bible. If a man's a going to go out and preach, he'd better preach that Bible. If he don't, the Lord won't carry him through." That's right. Now that's a good point of people having a good education now. If you read that Bible pretty regular and you know the Bible pretty good, when the pastor gets up there on Sunday morning and goes to preaching some stuff that ain't in the Bible, you know it, don't you? Yeah, you know it right there. Then you lose confidence in that man. Boy, that doesn't happen much in America today, does it? I know that. I've sat with them. I have too. Amen. I can agree. You see, that Bible was wrote on the wall. That was wrote for it to stand forever. You can't take nothing from it, nor add nothing to it. Amen. It just means what it says in there, and that's all. Yeah, no, sir, that's it. Then his wife says, "There's a lot of difference in church than what it used to be." Boy, if they were only alive today and could see the way the church has deteriorated since then. And there you have the picture of them. There's Happy Dowdle, and there's his wife, living out in the hills. An old hillbilly, and yet that man right there knows more of what the Lord expects out of the Bible, and he could spot the fake preachers that were coming with the new versions. He could say, "Wait a second, that's not in the Bible. They're adding and they're taking away." You know what the really sad thing is about that? A lot of the new version people make fun, and the educated class, those who deny the Word of God, the perfection of the King James Bible, they'll make fun of somebody like that. They'll laugh at, "Oh, the uneducated hillbillies out there." Uh-huh. Let me tell you something. I made reference to this earlier. Let me just read some scriptures, a couple more scriptures to you, about what God thinks about education. Let's read here in 1 Corinthians. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 26. "For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, But God hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. And why? Verse 29, that no flesh should glory in his presence. You better think about that if you're highly educated. You better think long and hard about that when you make fun of old hillbillies like that that have simple faith in a book. And let me tell you something. If you're one of these new versionists and your purpose is to destroy people's faith in the King James Bible and bring them down to your level of sin and infidelity and cause the unsaved world to blaspheme this book because of your wickedness and your corruption, you better repent. You better fall on your face while there's still time before you send, or before the Lord sends you into hell. Okay? There's not very much that makes me more angry in this life than this crowd right here. This crowd that defends this garbage and attacks the King James Bible. I know of lots and lots and lots of people that have had their faith in this book destroyed by this over here. It's disgusting. This is satanic. Makes my blood boil. Well, let's go over a couple points here to remember. And then we'll finish the video here. If you've made it this far, if you're a new versionist, I applaud you. Because most of you are thin-skinned and can't take a lot of rebuke. You start talking about libel and slander and things like this. Okay? Be a man. Okay? Take it. Point number one. Attacking the King James Version only gives aid and comfort to the enemy. You cause the Word of God to be blasphemed when you attack the King James Bible and offer nothing perfect to replace it with. When you have multiple versions, multiple contradicting versions that you call the Word of God, you cause God's book to be blasphemed. Point number two, the new versions all are tied to the Roman Catholic Church. Documented. Oh, that's a conspiracy theory. Oh, conspiracy-minded believers. Oh, conspiracy. Conspiracies in the Bible. Okay, God actually said to different people throughout the Bible, there's a conspiracy. Conspiracy is in the dictionary. See, they use this term that has been used by the news media to brainwash people. As soon as they hear conspiracy, they go, oh, I don't believe in that. But it is a conspiracy. I mean, if Satan was going to create a counterfeit Bible, what would it look like? It would look like this. It wouldn't look like the Satanic Bible by Anton LaVey. It would look like that. I mean, you see? Counterfeit. Satanic counterfeit. True Word of God. Number three, point number three. The no perfect Bible crowd of professing quote-unquote Christians is forced to join with Muslims, atheists, evolutionists, Catholics in their attacks on the King James Version. Isn't that weird? I've seen these people that attack the King James Version, they profess to be Christians, and they use the same arguments and the same attacks that the atheists use. Isn't that weird? Do you reckon the Holy Spirit is behind that movement right there? Is the Holy Ghost telling these people what to say in attack against the King James Version? No. You know, I guess maybe the Holy Ghost is inspiring the same attacks that the new versionists use, and he's also inspiring the atheists and Catholics and evolutionists. Right. Point number four. Only someone who is King James only can answer the lost in terms of Bible versions. You have somebody that's lost that comes along, like Ken Hovind did in the clip I showed earlier there. Which one? Oh, the Bible says it. Which one? The King James Bible. It's easy. I'm King James only. I can do that. You can't do that if you're over here. Which one? Oh, they are all the Word of God. They all say the same thing. No, they don't. You make yourself out to be a fool if you proclaim that these are all saying the same thing. Anybody, a third grader, a fifth grader, third grader, three-year-old, anybody, I mean, if they learn how to read at that age, they could prove you wrong. Anyhow, let's continue on here. Point number five. Why are there no NIV-only groups? I don't know of any. Point number six. The end times in which we are now living, and there again, if you don't believe we're in the end times, you, I feel sorry for you. We are living in the end times, and the Bible says that it would be a time of falling away, not a time of revival. Let's look at a couple verses here quick. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 3. Let no man deceive you by any means, for that day shall not come except there come a falling away first, and that man of sin be revealed, the son of perdition. The falling away there is not the rapture. Okay, I do believe in a pre-tribulation rapture. I do teach a pre-tribulation rapture, but I don't have to try and twist that scripture to make it teach a pre-tribulation rapture. Okay, it doesn't. Okay, at least not the falling away somehow means the catching up. No, it doesn't. Okay, the falling away there means apostasy. That's what it means. And that's exactly what has happened. I mean, I can go back to my childhood, which is not that far back. You know, I'm not that old. But I can go back to my childhood. There were no churches like there are today back when I was a kid. You know, the churches now are wicked. They are just an abomination. It's disgusting what goes on in the modern churches. You know, I wouldn't be caught dead in one. 1 Timothy chapter 4, verses 1 through 2. We'll go there next. Now the Spirit speaketh expressly that in the latter times some shall depart from the faith, giving heed to seducing spirits and doctrines of devils, speaking lies in hypocrisy, having their conscience seared with a hot iron. Hello, you a new versionist? Or one of these King James only people that preaches out of the King James Bible, but you don't believe it's God's word? You know what you do? You speak lies in hypocrisy. And the Holy Ghost has not told you to say and to be a liar like you are. The father of lies is Satan, not the Lord. And you stand up there and you say, turn in your Bible and we will read what the Word of God has for us today. Why would you call a book the Word of God when you don't believe it's perfect? When you believe it has errors in it? Speaking lies in hypocrisy. You see, if you say to the saved, I don't believe the King James Bible is perfect, I believe in the NIV or something, but the NIV is not perfect either. But then you turn around to the lost and you say, this is God's perfect Word. In God's inspired and errant word. You are a lying hypocrite. That's what you are. So you see there, in those three verses, and there are plenty more, okay, evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. I mean, you could spend an hour looking at all the scriptures to talk about a spiritual falling away in the last days. And yet somehow, you know, the new versions aren't part of it. You know, it's ridiculous. They are the cause of it. Okay, they change the truth of God into a lie. Subject for another video. So, the end times is characterized by an incredible falling away. A famine of hearing the word of the Lord. Even says that back in the Old Testament, book of Amos. But finally, I just want to end this video with a little bit of instruction for King James Bible believing Christians. Okay? Here, this is for you. If you're a new versionist, this doesn't apply to you. Okay? Well, it does, but in a negative sense. King James Bible believers. 2 Timothy chapter 4, verses 2 through 4. Preach the word. How can you preach the word if you don't have it? Okay? That's why I said this is for King James Bible believers. Preach the word. Be instant in season, out of season. Reprove, rebuke, exhort with all longsuffering and doctrine. Reprove, rebuke. Those are negative. Exhort, that's positive. Don't be all negative. Don't be all positive. Okay? You do need to do some reproving. You need to do some rebuking. But you also have to exhort. I'm going to do some more videos on that in the future. But with all long-suffering and doctrine. I know that my fellow King James Bible believers on here on YouTube, you are all long-suffering. Okay? A lot of people get on and they start getting some attacks and they quit. Those of you that have been on here for a while, you've had to practice the thing of being long-suffering. You're taking your time out to be here to strengthen people's faith in the Word of God. Your labor's not in vain. Okay? But let's continue on here. Verse 3. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lusts shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. And they shall turn away their ears from the truth and shall be turned unto fables. That's the kind of garbage that people are going to go for. James White's ridiculous nonsense. Why? Because they will not endure sound doctrine. They don't want to return to the old paths. They want to go forward, move forward. You know, we believe in evolution. The Bibles get better with time. Well, then when are we going to expect a perfect Bible? If all these new versions have come out and they're getting better and better and better and better, well, common sense would tell you that they eventually become perfect. And yet that's not what they believe. That's not what they teach. You see, no, the reality of it is evolution is a fairy tale for grown-ups. Okay, Ruckman's got some good stuff on that. Perfection was here. For almost 400 years, it's been available. The King James Bible. This is your standard. Okay? And the time is going to come when the people will not endure this. Do not expect to be here on YouTube and get a million viewers and 5,000 subscribers. Our time is limited here on YouTube. These new versionists, the sodomites, the Catholics, the New Agers, evolutionists, atheists, there's one group and one book that they're against. Right here. The modern conform to the world. They look like the world. They act like the world. They talk like the world. They listen to the world's music. They fit in. The King James Bible believed that gets out on the street and preaches and yells and tells people about their sin and talks about hell and repentance and things like that and King James onlyism. We're the crowd that's on the way out. Okay? The time has come, when people aren't going to endure this book. So what's your job here on YouTube? Your job is to get those few that are out there. Okay? And the ones that are confused about the issue, show them the truth. That's why you're here. That's why I'm here. Do you think I have all kinds of spare time to just come here and make videos and post them and spend hours and hours and hours and hours putting these things together? Why am I here? If I couldn't give you a perfect book, what on earth would be the point? I'm here because I want people to have the authority of God's Word in their own hands and to be able to be taught by the Holy Spirit. Okay? And by the way, for those of you out there, the Alexandrian cult philosophy, they say that the King James Bible doesn't say Holy Spirit. Yes, it does. Here's the reference. Okay? The King James Bible uses both. Another issue. But that's it for right now. Be careful. If you are a new versionist, let me just say this. Be careful that what you post on here isn't used by the lost world to blaspheme this book. Because God's going to have something to say about that. All right? King James Bible believer, continue in the things which you've learned. Earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered to the saints. Okay, that's it. Thank you for watching. It's been a long video, but thank you for enduring. That's it.
Let me move on. Let me talk about how the Hegelian dialect is working the Bible translation issue. Let's take this man over here for an example. He believes that the Bible is the inspired Word of God. It has no errors in it whatsoever. There are zero mistakes in the Bible, and everything that he reads in this book came down from heaven. You believe that? Say amen. Now, here's a man over here who he sees the book, the Bible is just a bunch of fairy tales, or he might believe that some of it came from God or whatever, or it's a book of good principles, but it's not the Word of God. So this idea over here says it's the Word of God. This idea over here says that it's not the Word of God. And when you take these two things and you meld them together, you have a new synthetic doctrine about the Bible. And it's characterized by the following quotations. Each translation has the power to transform your life. The voice of God can speak to you through each one. Always use more than one translation. Let the Lord speak to you through more than one voice. All versions can help us to hear the voice of God. The Bible is not what it appears to be. It has no single author representing a uniform and consistent point of view. Oh, yes, it does. It does have one single author, doesn't it? God. And it is one consistent point of view. And they say, what they're telling you is, you get out about 10 different Bible translations when you're studying the scriptures. Or since the books are too big, we'll sell you some software that has 14 different Bible translations on it and transliterations and all this stuff. And then somewhere, you will be able to accurately hear, maybe, what God's saying. That's a new synthetic doctrine concerning the Bible. Here's how that works out. Let me show you what the Bible says. Thy word is very pure. Do you believe that? Say amen. Therefore thy servant loveth it. Psalm 119, thy word is true. From where? Beginning. Do you believe Genesis 1? Do you believe that God created the earth in 6 days? Thy word is true from the beginning, and every one of thy righteous judgments endureth forever. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified 7 times. Thou shalt, notice the future tense. From this point, David was saying, it will always be preserved. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord, thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. Now I'm going to get into what I'm going to do for you tonight is I'm going to put up here on the screen. I'm going to show you the differences. They say get out many translations. So what I'm going to do for you tonight is I'm going to show you the King James translation on one side and some of the other translations on the other. And then this new synthetic doctrine says that even where they're disagreeing, you should be able to hear God's voice somewhere in the middle. And this changing comes 3 ways. Number one, changing of the reading. In other words, making it say something completely different. Or number 2, omission of part of the verse. Or number 3, omission of all of a verse. Let me show that. Put it up on the screen. Number 1, here's the King James. It says, Hosea 11, Ephraim compasseth me about with lies, and the house of Israel with deceit. But Judah yet ruleth with God, and is faithful with the saints. Now, what I want you to concentrate on is the fact that Judah rules with God and is faithful. That is what the King James Bible says. The NIV says Judah is unruly against God and against the faithful and holy one. So what you're seeing here is that one of these versions is not telling you the truth, is it? One of these, what they're saying, they are two totally contradictory statements from one Bible to the other. And yet the new doctrine says that we're supposed to hear God's voice somewhere in here. But you know what? God is not the author of confusion. And if one verse says that Judah rules with God and the other verse says that Judah is unruly, which one's right? Well, God's right, but which one did God say? And so you have to see, what we're doing is we're saying that there really is no standard for what's right. If you work in the construction industry and you go to the lumber yard to buy pre-cut 2x4 lumber, that I guarantee you that man at that lumber yard is going to know what a pre-cut is. It's a pre-designed, pre-fabricated. It's cut to exact specification. And if I live in St. Louis, and if I were to go to a St. Louis lumber yard or Topeka, Kansas lumber yard and order a pre-cut, I guarantee you they're going to be the exact same size because there's a standard, right? You know, there's a standard for everything. In medical science, there's a standard. In biology, there's a standard. In grocery stores, there's a standard. In gas stations, there's a standard. In a pack of cigarettes, there's a standard, right? But for some reason, the most important issue that mankind will ever deal with, the salvation of his soul, for some reason, there's no standard. We've replaced the Word of God. Now, Genesis 22:2, King James, and he said, "Take now thy son, thine only son Isaac, whom thou lovest, and get thee into the land of Moriah, and offer him there for a burnt offering." Now, this is very, very important. The King James says that God told Abram to offer him. The NIV has God telling Abraham to sacrifice him. Is there a difference? Follow the steps of Abraham now. If God told him to offer him, Abraham takes his son, lays him on the altar, and does exactly what God told him to do because he offered him there. If God, however, told him to sacrifice him, then what Abraham must do, in spite of who he hears from, he must take that child, lay it on the altar, draw back that knife, and plunge it into his body and kill him because God said to do it. And you remember the story, the angel of the Lord showed up and said, "Abraham, don't touch your son. Don't put your knife to him. Don't kill him." Now, hold on a minute. Watch this. God said kill him, and angel says not to kill him. Who are we supposed to believe? And by the way, if God said kill your son, the Bible is clear. God doesn't change. God would not go back and say, "Now, Abraham, don't kill your son." What, you didn't mean it? Were you lying, God, when you told me to do that? You see the difference? I believe one of them is lying. And yet we're supposed to believe that we can hear the voice of God somewhere in the middle here. "Therefore, the Lord himself shall give you a sign. Behold, a virgin shall conceive." Do you believe in the virgin birth of Jesus Christ? Say amen. Amen. Okay? That's the King James. The RSV says a young woman will conceive. Now, I don't know what it's like in Topeka, Kansas, but where I come from, young women are conceiving all the time. Yeah. And that's not anything miraculous, is it? In fact, it's a shame what's going on. And so, you know what? They have removed the virgin birth doctrine of Jesus Christ right out of the Bible. And yet we're supposed to believe that you can hear God's voice in here somewhere. "But thou, Bethlehem Ephratah, though thou be little among the thousands of Judah, yet out of thee shall he come forth unto me, that is to be ruler in Israel, whose goings forth have been from old, from everlasting." What this is saying is that the Jesus, the Messiah, who was born in Bethlehem, he didn't have his origin in Bethlehem. He never had an origin. He was everlasting to everlasting. Jesus said, "I always was, always am, and always will be." Do you believe that? Say amen. He always was. Now watch this. The New International Version says that he has an origin. And an origin is a beginning. And you know what the devil knows? The devil knows what we know, that things that have a beginning have a what? Stop and think about what's going on. And yet we're supposed to believe that we can hear God's voice here. And Matthew 18, "And said, Verily, verily I say unto you, except ye be converted, ye be converted, and become as little children, ye shall not enter into the kingdom of heaven." That is what the King James says. Notice what the NIV says. "And he said, I tell you the truth, unless you change." Now, what is the difference here? I didn't convert myself. I didn't save myself. I didn't wash my own sins away. Who did it? God did. Jesus did. He did it for me because I couldn't do it for myself. And yet the NIV has Jesus saying that you need to change. And isn't that what most lost people believe anyway? They say, "Well, you know, I would like to come to your church, but I tell you what, I'd be a hypocrite if I came." Hey, come sit down next to the rest of the hypocrites. Amen? Because you know what? You cannot clean up your life. Only God can. "For God so loved the..." Hey, say this verse with me. "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." You know one of the... How many of you just know that verse by heart? Say amen. Amen. Boy, and you know why? Because when you were growing up, you went to a church and everybody in all the churches had one Bible, and it was the old King James Bible. And they taught you scripture memorization from one Bible. So you know what's going on now in the church? And by the way, David said, "Thy word have I hid in my heart that I might not sin against God." I guarantee you, you put enough Bible verses in there, it'll keep you away from sin. Amen? So you know what's going on in the church right now? Nobody can memorize scripture because they don't know what version to memorize them from. A teacher in a Sunday school class cannot lead students to memorize scriptures because they're all using different Bibles. They've taken the word of God out of the hearts of these children. Notice that the focus here is on that he gave his only begotten Son. That is a verb that means what it says, that Jesus came forth from the Father. And so the New English Version has omitted begotten and just calls him his only son. The RSV calls him his only son. He's omitted begotten. The NIV, his one and only son. It has omitted the doctrine of the begetting of the Father of Jesus Christ. It's taken it completely out. And yet we're supposed to believe we can hear God's voice in here. All scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. It says all scripture. So you know what that means? Genesis 1:1 to Revelation 22:21, God gave it. Now I want you to notice this first. I like this because it says all scripture is given. You know what that? My English teacher taught me that is a present tense. It doesn't say that all scripture was given. And you know what? I didn't read the Bible 2,000 years ago. I read the Bible now. And so you know what this tells me? That when I read the scriptures, the Holy Ghost of God is giving me the inspiration of God. Right here, right now, is given. Now watch this. The New English Version says every inspired scripture has its use. It's saying that not all the scripture is inspired. And without controversy, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh. You believe that? Say amen. That's the King James. The NIV says he appeared in a body. Who? But it doesn't say God, does it? And to the degree that you remove the deity of Christ from Christ, I'll show you that in a minute, who was delivered for our offenses and was raised again for our justification. The death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is what caused our deliverance and our justification. However, the New King James Version says he was delivered up because of our offenses and was raised because of our justification. It is removing what Jesus did as part of our salvation experience. And yet we're supposed to believe that God's voice can be heard in here somewhere. For we are not as many which corrupt the word of God. Even the corruption of the word of God was going on in Paul's day. So the NIV says, and like so many, we do not peddle the word of God for profit. Oh yeah, they do. In fact, that's why they print all these new Bibles all the time. You know why? So they can copyright them. So that if you quote from them, you have to pay them a dime. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Notice, and we're supposed to somewhere hear God's voice in here. That same reading is also found in the New King James Version of the Bible. Mark chapter 10. And the disciples were astonished at his words. But Jesus answered again and said unto them, children, how hard is it for them that do what? Trust in riches to enter into the kingdom of God. And yet the NIV says how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. I'm telling you, it's not hard. Unless you're full of pride. Amen. It's not hard. You know what you do? You call in the name of the Lord and you shall be saved. Where's God's voice here? I don't get it. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? Now we said this was who? We said it was the devil, right? O Lucifer, son of the morning. That's what the King James Bible says. Now watch this. In the NIV, it calls him the morning star. Now, why is that so deadly? This sister got it over here. I'm going to show you something. The King James says in Revelation 22:6 that Jesus is the morning star. They're saying that Jesus fell from heaven. No, he didn't. He came down because he loved us. God didn't kick him out of heaven. But I know somebody that wishes that Jesus was kicked out of heaven. You hear a conspiracy going on here? No wonder. I put up here, no wonder. No wonder what? There shall be no whore of the daughters of Israel, nor a sodomite of the sons of Israel. That means that there ought not be any gays, queers, homosexuals, sodomites in the land of Israel. Do you believe that? Say amen. God said he wouldn't put up with it. Amen. God said he wouldn't put up with it. Now the NIV says no Israelite man or woman is to become a shrine prostitute. So no wonder we have sodomites standing behind pulpits. Let me hear you say amen. It's no wonder we have sodomite weddings going on inside the church. And yet we're supposed to hear God's voice in here somewhere. No wonder. And there were also Sodomites in the land, and they did according to all the abominations of the nations which the Lord had cast out before the children of Israel. And there again it says there were male shrine prostitutes. You'll not find the word Sodomite in the NIV. No wonder. For he shall be great in the sight of the Lord, and shall neither drink wine nor strong drink. And he shall be filled with the Holy Ghost even from his mother's womb, because God says that as soon as that child is conceived in there, it belongs to him, doesn't it? And yet the NIV says he shall be filled with the Holy Spirit even from birth. And so no wonder it's the churches that are telling the politicians, it's okay, abort the babies. And the politicians get to stand in the pulpits of the churches who are pro-choice, which basically means they're pro-murder, because the devil had it taken out of the Bible that he can be filled with the Holy Ghost from his mother's womb. No wonder. Which one? Here's a change in the reading. And knew her not till she had brought forth her firstborn son, and he called his name Jesus. Remember, the firstborn things belong to God, don't they? So Jesus must have been the firstborn. But he had no union with her until she gave birth to a son. Notice that the firstborn issue is taken completely out of the scriptures. And Joseph and his mother marveled. I like this because King James got it right. Joseph is not the father of Jesus, was he? He's not the father of Jesus. And the NIV says the child's father and mother. They're saying that Joseph was Jesus' father. That's wrong, isn't it? And yet we're supposed to believe. We can hear God's voice in here. And Jesus answered him, saying, it is written that man shall not live by bread alone, but by what? How many words of God? And when the Bible says every, does it mean every? So you know what? If I don't have every word of God in my hand tonight, how can I live? How can I live? Man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word of God. That's the King James. The NIV says man does not live by bread alone, and then it ends it right there. It's omitted the rest of the verse. And Jesus answered and said unto him, get thee behind me, Satan, for it is written, thou shalt worship the Lord thy God, and him only shalt thou serve. That's the King James. NIV says, Jesus answered, it is written. Wait a minute. Where's the get thee behind me, Satan? I kind of like that, don't you? That shows a little attitude on Jesus' part, doesn't it? Get thee behind me, Satan. Amen. Somebody say amen. But it's taken out of the Bible now. So how can you have a little attitude with the devil? Amen. Haven't you wanted to do that to him too? Get thee behind me, Satan. Amen. Man, I'll bring the shout out of you here in a minute, all right? Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me hath everlasting life. Can you believe in Buddha and be saved? Can you believe in Muhammad and be saved? Can you believe in politics and be saved? Can you believe you'll have another beer and be saved? No. So it says, believeth on me, right? He who believes has everlasting life. That's what the NIV says. And every spirit that confesseth not that Jesus Christ is come in the flesh is not of God. And this is that spirit of who? See, the Bible's trying to give us a clue how to spot the Antichrist. Because he will not confess that Jesus came in the flesh. And so the NIV says, but every spirit that does not acknowledge Jesus is not from God. What have they omitted? In the flesh. So let me ask you a question. Where is the spirit of Antichrist in which Bible translation? The NIV. It's there because it did not acknowledge that Jesus came in the flesh. This verse is completely gone out of practically every translation of the Bible except the King James and the New King James. It says, howbeit this kind goeth not out but by prayer and fasting. Now, I'll tell you this, that is one place in the Bible that it says it. There's actually two places. And the Bible says, out of the mouth of two witnesses shall every word be established. And so Jesus was establishing a doctrine of spiritual warfare that when some of these foul spirits just won't leave you alone, you know what you do? You pray and you fast, because Jesus said that's how it's going to be. And so think about it. The devil's pretty slick, isn't he? He took the keys of spiritual warfare right out of the Bible. Because this verse is completely omitted. NIV, New American Standard, Revised Standard, I mean, you name it. Holman Standard, they're all, this verse is completely gone. This verse is gone. For the Son of Man has come to save that which is lost. That verse is completely gone out of every version, perversion of the Bible, except the King James and the New King James. Matthew 23:14, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye devour widows' houses, and for a pretense make long prayer. Therefore ye shall receive the greater damnation. You know what Jesus was preaching against? False religion. And putting on a show in church. Jesus was preaching against that, wasn't he? And yet that verse is now gone out of the Bible, except the King James. Where their worm dieth not, and the fire is not quenched. Here is the evidence right here of the Hegelian dialect now at work in the doctrine of hell. You see, I sort of want to pattern myself after the old hellfire preachers. Amen. I like those guys. Amen. They just preached hell was hot. And that saved sinners. And the church went for thousands of years believing that hell was hot. But now, for some reason, we've got a new doctrine that's coming out of our pulpits and out of our so-called Christian leaders. And I could stand here and name names of people who believe this, and you'd go, oh, but it's true. That says that hell is not on fire. That the fire is merely a symbol of the separation of God. So hell's not on fire. So we have a hell's on fire. There is no hell. Now we have a new doctrine that says hell is not on fire. And maybe it has something to do with the fact that the verse that says it is gone out of their Bibles. But if you do not forgive, neither will your Father which is in heaven forgive your trespasses. That verse gone out of all the new translations except the King James, New King James. I had trouble getting these verses on the screen. There's so many of them. This is Mark chapter 16, verses 9 through 20. Now, I'll be honest with you. If you go to the bookstore and buy an NIV, shame on you, number one. But I have one. I bought, and let me just tell you where I'm at on this thing. If 8 years ago, if you had asked me, am I going to be standing behind pulpits preaching the King James Bible that it's the Word of God, I'd have told you no, because at that time I didn't believe it. At that time, I believed what people had told me, that the Bible was full of mistakes, and it didn't matter what translation you use, as long as people understood the Word of God. And so I didn't believe it. But I've got an NIV that I bought for my wife, and I looked at it. Out of all honesty, it has these verses there, but they place a line right underneath verse 8, and then they put a caption there that says, the most reliable early manuscripts and other ancient witnesses do not have Mark 16, 9 through 20. So they're, you know what they're saying? You have our permission to not believe verse 9, verse 10, verse 11, verse 12, verse 13, 14, 15, and 16. You have our permission that even if you read it, you don't have to believe it because we don't think God said it. And I say, woe be to them. He that taketh away from these words, I will take away his name out of my book. Isn't that what God said? Now, what they don't tell you is, and I am not qualified, I'm not going to stand here and give you manuscript evidence because I'm not qualified to teach on manuscript evidence. But I will tell you that what they didn't tell you is that there are a lot of early manuscripts and there are a lot of ancient witnesses that do say that those verses belong there. I just believe they do. This verse is gone. Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. And he answered and said, I believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God. That verse is completely gone. And why is that important? Because this deals with Philip's dealing with the Ethiopian eunuch. And Philip jumped up in the chariot. They were reading Isaiah 53. Oh, I love that. Oh, I love that. And the eunuch said, who's this talking about? And he went to preach to him Jesus. Amen. He's telling him about Jesus. And so you know what? They rode up past a little pond there. And he said, here's water. What doth prevent me to be baptized? And Philip said, if thou believest with all thine heart, thou mayest. Because you know what? Baptism in water doesn't save you, does it? No. Your belief in Jesus Christ, that's what saves you. But if you take this verse out of the Bible, what doth hinder me to be baptized? Well, they just jumped down and baptized him. And they're making it look like that saved him. Now stop and think about it. Is there a church or churches right now who believe that if you get sprinkled, dunked, or whatever in their water, you're saved? It's completely gone out of the Bible. Gone, gone, gone. This verse, completely gone. In fact, if you just want to judge whether or not a Bible's good or not, pick the Bible up and turn to 1 John 5:7. If that verse is not there, put it down, walk away. For there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Holy Ghost, and these three are one. You see, I believe that verse belongs in the Scriptures. And they say, well, it's not in the early manuscripts, it's not in this. Listen, there's enough evidence to convince me that that verse belongs in the Bible. And you know what? It just sounds like it belongs there. Amen? I believe that this verse not only has the evidence, but it has the testimony of the Holy Ghost of God to tell us that it belongs in the Scriptures. So you're starting to see right here, that there is a major, major difference between the King James Bible, the Bible that you grew up with, the Bible that your mama had, the Bible that your granddaddy had, the Bible that your forefathers who traversed from over in the east and they made their way over to through this land, covered wagon, old car, didn't matter. I guarantee you they didn't have much property, but I guarantee you that most of those families had an old King James Bible. It probably your ancestors, your great-great-granddaddy probably learned how to read by reading an old King James Bible. And you know what? It was good enough for them. You know what our preachers, you know what the great revivals in this country and those old circuit writing preachers, you know what they did? They didn't go to Bible college. They didn't have strong concordances. They didn't have 14 different commentaries and computer discs and all that stuff. They didn't have Christian radio and Christian psychology. Them old preachers, they had one thing. They had a King James Bible. And they just went out. And God put it in their heart to just believe what the Bible said. And they believed the Word of God and they preached it. And I'm telling you that God wrought a great work in this nation as a result of men who believed this old King James Bible. And so, no wonder the devil hates it so much and he's working so hard to get the King James out of the church, out of the colleges, out of the ministries. He's working fiercely. So he says, I'm going to give you these other versions. And I've cut some things out that I don't like, and I've changed some things that I don't like. Now, I will say this, that in the NIV, the New American Standard, the New King James, and others, I believe that they contain portions of the Word of God. In many cases, they have some of the same wording there. But for the most part, the Word of God. And remember, one drop of clean water doesn't purify a dirty glass. But one drop of dirt contaminates a clean glass. And that's all it takes. The Bible says if a man offends the law in one point, he's guilty of what? All. So, you know, the way God sees this thing, it's either pure or it's not. There's not degrees of purity in God's eyes. Amen? There are not degrees of purity in God's eyes. And so if God said that the words of the Lord are pure words, he means, and that he would preserve them pure forever, he means that there are zero mistakes in the Bible and there will never be one mistake, one error in the Scriptures. Not one. And that is what I believe concerning the Bible. Do you believe that? Say amen.
Amen.
Now, we've been focusing on all of the verses that the other translations have omitted from the scriptures that the King James has always had. Here is what, now when the NIV committee, when those men who helped translate the New International Version of the Bible, they sat down and they wrote out a book as sort of an apology for what it was that they had done to the scriptures. And they called it the NIV, the making of a translation. In that book, the authors, the editors actually accused the King James translators of violating scripture by adding these verses to the Bible. Their quote is, "The KJV adds to and so alters the word of God." So you know what I say to that? I mean, somebody's not telling the truth here. The King James translator said, "This is the word of God. We have everything in it that God said." And now the NIV translator said, "Oh, no, you don't. And you violated scripture by adding to it." And of course, I say they violated scripture by taking it out. Amen. But now you're going to see that they have these translators of the NIV and probably some others of the other versions. They're not just saying that the King James is not as good a translation. You'll see that they actually hate the King James Bible. Let me show you the difference. The King James says, "We have also a more sure word of prophecy, whereunto you that you do well that you take heed." Now, what that was talking about, Peter is talking about how he was there when he heard the Lord's voice from heaven boom down and say, "This is my beloved Son in whom I well pleased." Peter went around telling everybody, he said, "I heard God say, this is my beloved Son. I heard the voice. It came from heaven. I heard him say it." But he said, "You know what? You don't have to believe me. We have a more sure word of prophecy that will testify to you that Jesus is the Son of God." And yet the NIV says, "And we have the word of the prophets made more certain." Notice that one is less than the other. So who do we believe? "Thy word is true, is very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it." Talking, that's the King James. "Thy word is very true, therefore," or "they're very pure, therefore thy servant loveth it." NIV says, "Your promises have been thoroughly tested, and your servant loves them." You know what that's saying? That's saying that I have verified the Bible, and I say it's true. That's what it means. Your promises have been thoroughly tested, right? That's what it means. "Thy word is true" from where? From the beginning. Do you believe that God created the universe in 6 days, like he said? That's true. "Thy word is true" from the beginning. And the NIV says, "All your words are true," but they have omitted "from the beginning." They've taken it out of the scriptures. "The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified 7 times. And now in verse 7, we have the doctrine of preservation. "Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever." There is the doctrine of preservation. And yet the NIV changes the verse to say, "O Lord, you will keep us safe and protect us." So they have omitted the doctrine of preservation. "All scripture is given by inspiration of God." This is the King James. "And it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works." And notice that in the NIV rendering, it says, "so that the man of God may be thoroughly equipped," but it is omitted "that the man of God may be perfect." Now, I want you to stop and think about this for a minute. If you believe, and let me tell you what's at the core of all this Bible translation stuff, is that if you find preachers, pastors, teachers, theologians, college professors, laymen in a church who say that it's okay to use these other translations, knowing that there is a difference, a major difference between the NIV or the NASB and the King James, they will make the statement that, well, no translation is perfect. They say that no translation really accurately portrays what the original Greek and Hebrew, and oh, by the way, we're not even sure what the original Greek and Hebrew said because all we have is copies, and we're pretty sure that there are errors in those copies, and so what they're really saying is that for 4,000 years now, there has never been a perfect Bible. Well, that's what they're saying. So since they believe that there are errors and mistakes in the Bible, since they believe that they don't have a perfect Bible, therefore, if you don't have a perfect Bible and the Bible makes you perfect, then if you have an imperfect Bible, what will the Bible make you? Imperfect. That's exactly right. Do we believe God or men? Now the Bible says, let God be true and every man a liar. Do you believe that? Say amen. Every man is capable of telling things that are not true. We have a fallen, sinful nature. The Bible says the heart of man is desperately wicked and deceitful above all things. Isn't that the truth? Amen. And it doesn't matter how long you've been saved, how glorified, sanctified, holified you are, you still have a sin nature and your heart is still desperately wicked, deceitful. And if it wasn't for the grace of God, you wouldn't be able to tell the truth. Somebody, I mean, that's just the truth, right? You kind of get an idea of what kind of preacher I am. Amen. So what do we believe, God or men? If God says one thing and man says, oh, no, 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 you can't believe that, then rationality should say, well, we should believe God. But you see, what's coming out of our pulpits and out of our Bible colleges is, yeah, we know your Bible says that, but let us tell you that that probably shouldn't be in there, or that was translated incorrectly, or in the original Hebrew it doesn't, or that is a textual variant and it probably shouldn't be in the Bible to begin with. Well, look at it. The Bible says thy word is very pure. That is what God said. He said it's very pure. And yet the NIV committee said there are mistakes in the transmission of text. So God said there are no impurities in the Bible. The NIV committee says there are mistakes in the Bible. So who do we believe? The word of the Lord endureth forever. Means that it will always be perfect. And yet the NIV committee says the Bible is the words of men, a literary production. Well, I thought it was the word of God. Amen. I thought that's what God said. God said it was his word. NIV committee says it's man's word. Every word of God is pure. That's what God said. J.B. Phillips of the Phillips Bible said, I felt bound to abandon the God dictated every word from cover to cover attitude. Now, God said that every word of God is pure. Man said, I don't think God said all these things. Who do we believe? The words of the Lord are pure words. We have also a more sure word of prophecy. That is what God said. Man said every member of the panel was conscious that some of its decisions were in no sense certain. That's the New English Bible Translating Committee. In other words, God said it's positive, it's sure. You can, hey, listen, you can lay your head down at night and know that this is the inspired, infallible word of God. That is what God said. But man said, we're not really that sure. Till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. Calvin Linton of the NIV committee says the Bible is, quote, God's message and not his words. He believes that the Bible is the wrong side of a beautiful embroidery. The picture is still there, but knotted, blurry, not beautiful, not perfect. He calls Christians amusingly uninformed who presume the Holy Spirit dictated the actual words of the text of the original writers. He's saying that you people sitting here tonight are stupid and uninformed, and you poor people, you just haven't gone to Bible college is your problem. You haven't gone to seminary and you haven't read my book because I said that it's not the Word of God. And so you just poor people. You know what that is? It's called the doctrine of the Nicolaitans. And Jesus said, I hate it. And that word means conquering the laity. And that is at the basis of all the mystery religions where the priest or the preacher or the prophet or the guru or the medicine man, what he says goes. And there is no sure word to back him up. He says, God told me that you're to bring your daughter here for us to sacrifice. And you know what? The people did it. Isn't that something? So when you have a man standing behind the pulpit who says, you don't really have the Word of God in your hands. But I will tell you what he said. That's mystery religion, doctrine of the Nicolaitans. That's what it is. Here is what in the book, the NIV, the making of a contemporary translation, here is what they said. Listen to the hate that they have for the King James. Do not give them a loaf of bread covered with an inedible, impenetrable crust, fossilized by 3.5 centuries. For any preacher or theologian who loves God's word to allow that word to go on being misunderstood because of the veneration of an archaic, not understood version of 4 centuries ago is inexcusable and almost unconscionable. Do you hear the hate in this man's voice for the old authorized Bible? Now, how many of you recognize this symbol? Oh, yeah, you pull out a dollar. It's there, right? It's the mark of the New World Order, that eye in that capstone. Notice that that eye is illuminated. That represents a mystic teaching that goes all the way back to the Garden of Eden, that man has a third eye in him somewhere, and it needs to be open. Have you heard of that teaching before? Have you ever seen a woman from India who bears that religious mark where? Upon her forehead, that is a symbol that her third eye, her inner consciousness, has been opened up. And that's what this symbol represents. It is a mark. And notice that there on your dollar bill, it says, Anuit coeptus novus ordo seclorum, which means he favors the undertaking of a new world order. And that is the conspiracy that the devil is driving at right now. He's trying to bring a new world order system. There are videos and books all over this table that talk about bringing in, how the devil is bringing in various ways, the new world order. I believe he's using the Bible translations to do it. In the King James, in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, the Bible says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are passed away. Hey, somebody say amen to that, right? Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And yet notice that the NIV is trying to get you to understand that God is bringing in, or the New English Bible, that God is trying to bring in a new order. By the way, that's what Hitler called his reign over Germany and his future reign over the world. He called it the New Order. In the King James, the Bible says, which stood only in meats and drinks and divers washings, carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation, talking about when Jesus came and brought in the New Testament. And yet the NIV called it the time of the New Order. So I believe the devil is saying that he's bringing in. And there's even a Bible called God's Word for a New Age. I believe it's a New Age Bible, don't you? Now watch this. This eye and this capstone, I pulled this graphic. Notice the relationship that the eye, the illuminated eye in the capstone, has with various religious ideas. In fact, what we're seeing going on in this world is that the devil is bringing all the components of all the religions in the world. And we know from the scriptures that there's going to be a new world order political system and a new world order religious system. And it's going to be a combining of all of the religions of the world into one. That's what that represents. I found this cover on Science Digest. Notice the illuminated eye in the capstone. Notice there at the bottom there, it says genius awakened. It's talking about illumination of that third eye. Forbes magazine, notice the illumination there. Notice the caption, the coming light years. Notice that it's all talking about a time of illumination. Now that's called, let me go back to that slide for a minute. That's called the capstone of a pyramid. The capstone of the pyramid. So if I were to reference for you something about the capstone, if you were in a secret society such as Freemasonry, or you were in some Illuminati organized group and they speak in a different language, they use a symbolic language when they speak. It's called doublespeak. And the word they say that they say may mean something to everybody else, but it means something else to those who are illuminated and initiated into the same mystery religion they are. So when you hear, and I'll show you this tomorrow night, when you hear a president stand up before Congress and talking about a new world order, he's talking in a secret language that he knows and some other people know, but most everybody else will not know. And I'll show you that tonight. The coming, so remember that capstone thing. God said in Isaiah 28, therefore, thus saith the Lord God, behold, I lay in Zion for a foundation stone. Now, let me ask you a question. You saw that graphic there. The graphic has the capstone where? The top or the bottom? It's at the top, right? Now, God said that he lays in Zion a foundation stone. Where's the foundation stone? The top or the bottom? It's on the bottom, isn't it? Right? A tried stone, a precious cornerstone at the bottom, a sure foundation. In Psalm 118, the Bible says the stone which the builders refused is become the headstone of the corner. But Isaiah said that that's on the foundation, right? And then the King James, 1 Peter 2 says, unto you therefore which believe he is precious, but to them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, still on the foundation. And yet the NIV says that Jesus is the capstone. Wow. Listen, Jesus is not that third eye, illuminated eye in that capstone, folks. Amen. There it is right there. Mystic symbols. I got a screen full of different types of symbols here. Vera Alder, a modern witch and author of a book called Understanding the New Witch. I call it New Witch because it rhymes with sewage. You agree with that? Say amen. Amen. Understanding the New Witch. She says, quote, symbols are used to conceal certain knowledge from the masses. In other words, the secret elect have a symbol, and when they use that symbol, they know what it means. But the masses, the people who are driving up and down the road or watching television or reading a magazine or buying a product or reading a book, they don't know what that symbol means. But the people who put it there do, right? So let's concentrate on a symbol called the triquetra. The triquetra, okay? Kind of get this image in your mind of what it looks like, because if you will pick up a copy of the New King James Version of the Bible, you will more than likely find this symbol on that Bible. Now, let me say this out of fairness. I know that in most places, the New King James Version matches perfectly with the King James Bible. And I've had people come to me and say, Mike, I have a New King James. What do you think about that? Let me just kind of share with you. Number one, I just believe in the King James, okay? What I see in the New King James is an attempt to still remove people from what I believe is the standard, which is the King James Bible. It's basically one stepping stone to get them to come down from what I believe is the pure Word of God. Now, let me show you some things about the New King James Version. Number one, hell is omitted 22 times. So a Jehovah's Witness could come to your door and say, hell doesn't mean a place on fire, it means the grave. And they could go to a New King James Bible in 22 places and prove it to you. The word blood is omitted 23 times. The word repent is taken out 44 times. The word heaven is removed 50 times. God, the phrase God, is omitted 51 times. Lord is omitted 66 times. The words devil, damnation, Jehovah, New Testament are not found in the New King James. Now hold on a minute. God's own personal name, Jehovah, is not found in the New King James Version of the Bible. To me, that's just not right. Amen. It's just not right. So I decided to look at what that triquetra meant. Now, I have with me this week, I brought my wife and two of my children. We decided to go to the mall here in Topeka. And every time I go to the mall like that, I always like to go to the bookstore. I like to see books. I like to read books. And I just happened to walk by, and I promise you, you can do this just about every time. I don't encourage you to buy them. But if you'll walk by the New Age section or the occult section there in any big name bookstore, pick up a book on witchcraft or Wicca, and I promise you, almost without fail, you will find this symbol on that book. In fact, we were there the other day. I went into the bookstore. I looked at the New Age section right on the top shelf. Facing me was a new book that I'd never seen before on witchcraft, and there that symbol was right there. This woman by the name of Lorna Roberts has a website called Triquetra Journeys. She says that it represents the power of three witches united together. This is used in witchcraft to represent the feminine deity. There is a more secret symbolization in this triquetra that I will not deal with tonight. It is very vulgar and very nasty, but there is a reason why feminists and witches use this symbol. You'll find it on the, I have a copy of this book called The Aquarian Conspiracy. The Aquarian Conspiracy was a book written by Marilyn Ferguson back in the, it was written in the late 70s, came out in 1980. It's still being published now. You can still get a copy of it now. Marilyn Ferguson, and the book is about this thick. It's a very thick book. And she, and in this book, she has detailed what all the New Age movement and all the Aquarians and all the Illuminatis and all the secret societies, she's basically spilled the beans on what they're trying to do and how that the New Age movement has gone into the schoolhouses. Do you believe that? Say amen. The New Age movement's gone into the government sectors. It's in our government. And she said that it's in the churches too. And notice that she used this symbol. And I'm going to show you why here in a moment, why this symbol is so prominent and why this symbol is very important to the New Age movement. You'll find it on Ouija boards. Stop and think about this for a minute. You see, in God's religion, God has given us a sure word. And so all of us here tonight, if I say that Christ died on the cross for your sins, and that God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, you could sit there and say, amen, preacher, because your Bible says the same thing that my Bible does, doesn't it? You see, there's agreement. Can two walk together except they be agreed, the Bible says. Now, if I'm the only one who had a Bible, and you people were not allowed to have a Bible, remember Roman Catholicism? It's a mystery religion. You know why? Because the priests say we're the only ones who really should have a Bible. And they, listen, they let Catholics have Bibles now, but they don't like it. They still tell them, don't try to read it. We'll tell you what it means. That's mystery religion. So if I was the only one who had a Bible and none of you had a Bible, and I said, oh, the Bible says here that you have to pay me $10,000 a week. God said so. Where's the standard? How do you know that I'm telling you the truth? You don't, do you? You don't know. So think about it. You know what a Ouija board is? By the way, I encourage you, those of you here, those of you watching this video, do not let your kids play with Ouija boards. Do not let your kids go to somebody's house that has a Ouija board. Amen? You're going to lose your kids. So you know what a Ouija board is? It's the devil's version of the Bible. Because the person sits there, he takes the, I guess it's a mouse, I don't know what it is. But they hold that thing and they go into some trance. And then the devils from hell begin to move their hands and begin to write and spell out words. Boy, that's dangerous as a loaded pistol, amen? It's dangerous. Don't let your kids into that stuff. But notice the tri-catcher there. You see it there on another Ouija board, the tri-catcher there, the most prominent symbol there. Oh, by the way, there's a symbol up there on the upper right-hand corner that you've probably seen before. It's called the yin-yang. And the yin-yang is a Chinese symbol. Listen to this. Notice that it has a black dot in a white field and a white dot in a black field. And the Chinese philosophy of yin yang says that there is a little good in all evil and a little evil in all good. So you know what? The Hegelian dialect is seen in the symbol of the yin yang. It said, now remember what God said. God said in good there is no evil and in evil there is no good. That there is a difference between holy and unholy. And yet this philosophy says there isn't a difference between holy and unholy. Wow. Here's another one. This Ouija board is actually seen on a television show. Notice the symbol. And the television show is called Charmed. Have you ever heard of that show? I hope you haven't sat down and watched it, but I guarantee you, your kids or your grandkids have seen it. It's a very popular, in fact, witchcraft and the wicked religion is exploding in teenage girls right now. It's exploding in them. And it's exploding in church teenage girls. And there's even a book called Teen Witch, written by a Wiccan to teenage girls. And part of that book tells them that if your mom and daddy go to church, I'm going to teach you how you can sit down with your parents and get them to accept your new religion. So they watch TV shows called Charmed, and they watch TV shows like Buffy the Vampire Slayer and all of these other things, Teen Witch and Sabrina the Teenage Witch. My. Where have we gone in this country? We used to be a country of the Bible. Now we're a country of witchcraft. Notice the symbol there. And it's on a book that witches use called a book of shadows. And a book of shadows is like a witch's diary. They write down their dreams. They write down spells that they have learned or spells that they have used that work and so on. It says most neo-pagan religions are based on custom and experience rather than the written word. And that's interesting because we have a detailed description of what the false prophet is doing in the last days in the book Revelation. He is using signs and wonders. He is using experiences and entertainment to get people to follow this beast system that's coming in the last days because he has successfully removed the written word from the hearts of people. And it's all related to this symbol that I'm showing you tonight. How many of you remember a group, a rock group called Led Zeppelin? You remember them? Led Zeppelin, the lead singer, Jimmy Page, was a follower of a man by the name of Aleister Crowley. And I wish I could teach hours on the influence that Aleister Crowley, a warlock, a black magician, has had upon the media industry in this country, music, movies, television, books, you name it. These men were followers. The Beatles followed Aleister Crowley. A lot of rock groups, a lot of rock singers, film producers follow Aleister Crowley. Jimmy Page actually bought Aleister Crowley's mansion and moved into it. And he uses this symbol. Notice the symbol there that they use. This is from their website. They use it at their rock concerts. Now, Aleister Crowley designed a set of tarot cards. And this is the tarot card called the Hierophant. And I'm going to explain to you tonight what a Hierophant is in relation to the mystery religions that are coming on the earth right now. But I want you to notice that in his hand, he is holding a wand with the triquetra symbol on it. Now that is very, very important. I want you to get a hold of that. I also want you to notice something with me as you look at this tarot card. You'll see that on the four corners of the card, you see an eagle, you see a man, you see a lion, and you see an ox. Somebody tell me in the Bible where those are from. They're from the book of Ezekiel. Ezekiel was allowed to see, John was allowed to see, the throne of God with God sitting on the throne and supporting that throne were four living creatures, four beasts. One of them was an ox, one of them was an eagle, one of them was a man, and one of them was a lion. Now stop and think about this. They're saying that the Hierophant is God. Do you know who this is really? It's the devil. Notice that he has positioned himself to sit in the seat of God. Notice that he's holding the triquetra in his hand, and I'm going to show you why. By the way, there is even a supposedly Christian rock group who uses this symbol. You'll see it on churches. You'll see it in ministries all over the place. Now, the name of the group is called Avalon. Now, I'm going to tell you a little bit of something about Mike Hoggard. I've been raised in church all my life, but that doesn't mean I don't have a mean streak, all right? I remember when I was a teenager and a young person, I had a fascination with things that were slightly of the occult nature. I used to read the Lord of the Rings books. I would have been fascinated at the Harry Potter stuff when I was a teenager, when I was a kid. I used to read all the myths and legends concerning King Arthur and Merlin the magician. And when I saw this group called Avalon, I knew exactly what it was. You see, Avalon, in the legend of King Arthur and Merlin the magician, Avalon was a mystical island that existed that was the bridge to the underworld. Now, what does a Christian group have to do with the theme of the bridge to hell? And notice the symbol that they are using to do it with. I don't believe the devil's got all his eggs in one basket. I believe that he's using Bible translations. I believe he's using Christian music. Well, that's just what I believe, right? I mean, the devil wants to try to get into the church. This is how he's doing it. In fact, I found three different copies of this tarot card, and I know the graphics are not that clear, but on all three tarot cards, this Hierophant priest is holding a triquetra. Let me tell you who this Hierophant is and what he represents in the mystery religions. It says he teaches matters of faith, religion, belief, and morality. He is a wise teacher full of esoteric and occult knowledge. Esoteric means secret or hidden doctrines. He aids in understanding the occult mysteries. He holds the keys of transformation. What was he holding in his hand? The triquetra. Notice that they say he holds the keys. The triquetra is the key to transformation. He oversees the initiation of people into the mystery religions of ancient Babylon. Remember when I said that the false prophet doesn't force everybody to take the mark, he causes them, which means that this world is being taken on a ride toward initiation into the new world order beast power religion that's coming onto the earth. According to famed occultist Elise Bailey, she said there is no question that that the work to be done in familiarizing the general public with the nature of the mysteries is of paramount importance. In other words, she says, we know that we must get the general public at least familiar with the mystery religion. And she said, these mysteries will be restored to outer expression through the medium of what? The church. She said, because Christ is the Hierophant of the first and second initiations, he will administer the first initiation in the inner sanctuary of the church. Now you say, you know what? That's just some old occult thing. And you know what? None of that's true. And you know what? Yeah, I believe that it's all false and that's not going to happen. But let me tell you something. If a thief called you on the phone and said, at midnight, I'm coming to your house to rob you blind, you could say, well, you know what? You're a thief and you're probably lying. Right? You could say, you're a thief and you're probably, oh, this is a prank call. But you know what? The prudence says, and you know what the Word of God says? Sit up and wait at midnight. And if he comes in, I'll let you handle the rest. Amen? Okay? You figure out what to do with him when he gets in there. But you know what? You can believe him or not. But they said that they were coming into the church to begin the initiation process. I say that God's people had better be on their guard and watching and waiting, because our adversary, the devil, is as a roaring lion seeking whom he may devour. And I promise you, they said they're going to try to get it in the church. They're going to try to get it in the church. And then you can see in this triquetra three numbers. Six. Now, Thomas Nelson are the people who published the New King James Version of the Bible. This is the explanation that they use of why this symbol is on their Bible. They say that the triquetra is an ancient symbol for the Trinity. It comprises three woven arcs, distinct yet equal and inseparable, symbolizing that the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are three distinct yet equal persons and indivisibly one God. So what they're saying is that the triquetra is an artwork that tries to show you the Trinity. Hang on a minute. The Word of God says that we ought not think that the Godhead or the Trinity is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's device. So man said, we have come up with a piece of artwork that says that it shows the Trinity. And yet God said, don't bother. God said, do not grave artwork to try to show the Godhead, because number one, we can't do it. And I just think that God is wise enough to recognize and know that this symbol would be used in a secret way as a device to transform the church into a new world order system. Now, you've heard me preach on Bible numerics this week. I tell you that there is, I believe in the order of the Bible. We have four books in the Bible called the Gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. It's interesting that there are exactly four verses in the Bible that talk about another gospel. 2 Corinthians 11:4, Galatians 1:6, Paul warned us, he said it over and over and over, that though we or an angel from heaven preach any other gospel, gospel. Unto you than that which we have preached unto you, let him be accursed. As we said before, so now, so say I now again, if any man preach any other gospel unto you than that which we've received, let him be accursed. So Bible's warning us about a false gospel system coming into the church. Now I'm going to take you, remember, now let's get back to this Hegelian dialect thing here. And let's remember how it works. You have God's way on one side, the devil's way on the other. And he must bring God's people over to his way with a new synthetic doctrine. The Hegelian dialect was evident in Genesis chapter 3, and I'll show that to you. Genesis chapter 3, verse 1, and he said unto the woman, yea, hath God said. How many words there? 1, 2, 3, 4. So you know what I think? I think that this new false gospel has to do with what Lucifer said, yea, hath God said. In other words, you know what he's saying? He's saying, did God really say this? He is introducing the opposite of faith, which is doubt. Now, let me tell you something. The Bible says, for by grace are ye saved through faith. God's grace is his part. Our faith is our part. And faith basically means that you believe what God said, right? You believe what God said. Because the Bible says faith comes by hearing, and hearing by what? Christian radio? Well, maybe. Christian music? Jerry Springer? No. He said that faith comes by hearing, and hearing comes by the Word of God. And so you know what? If you don't believe the Word, you have no faith. Amen? If you don't believe the Word, you have no faith. You see, you say, well, I believe the Bible says Jesus died for my sins. Well, that's good. But then you say, I don't believe that God created the universe in 6 days, 6,000 years ago. That's not good. Because where do you draw the line on what you believe from the Bible and what you don't believe from the Bible? Remember what Jesus said, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. So God said, Adam, thou shalt not eat of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, for in the day that thou doest, thou shalt surely die. Adam transmitted that to his wife. The devil shows up in that form of the serpent, and he says, Eve, I looked in the original manuscripts, and in some of the original manuscripts, what Adam told you was in the Bible is not really in there. You see, because in a lot of these translations, they will put a little mark there next to a verse that is obviously missing or part of a verse that's missing, and they'll put a little notation down there that basically says the earliest manuscripts do not have this verse. You know what they're saying? Did God really say this? Yea, hath God said. You shall not eat of every tree of the garden. Now notice in Genesis 2:16, God said, and the Lord God commanded the man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat. So he's not even really quoting God right here. And then he said, but of the fruit of the tree, this is God saying this. No, this is the devil, excuse me. But of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, ye shall neither eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Excuse me, this is Eve saying this. You know what Eve has just done? She's added to the Word of God. God didn't say that they couldn't touch it. In fact, God told Adam to take care of the garden, didn't he? Adam's responsibility, and if you take care of plants, you got to touch them, right? But God never did say you couldn't touch them. Eve added to the Word of God. So already we're in trouble. You got the devil on one side saying, we're not sure God said this. Then you got the pride of Eve kicking up, adding to it. And boy, folks, we've got a recipe for disaster right here. Because in none of this is God's Word being accurately represented. The devil's not accurately representing it. And Eve, the church, is not accurately representing it either. So we have a recipe for disaster. But then the devil shows up in verse 4 and says, the serpent said to the woman, ye shall not surely die. You know what he did? he changed or he added one word. God said, ye shall surely die. The devil said, ye shall not surely die. God said this. The devil said this. And the new synthetic doctrine says that we're going to hear God's voice in here somewhere. I'm telling you it's not true. For God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, then your what? Eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. So I believe that the devil, since Genesis 3 on, has been marching mankind down a road of trying to bring him to a new consciousness that will regard Lucifer as the God of the universe. Now, I've spent all this time telling you about what is in all the other translations, the conspiracy that's going on to try to transform the church. And I'm going to end this video, I'm going to end this talk with what I believe the scriptures tell us what that you can believe about the Bible. See, I am limited as a Christian to only believe what God tells me to believe. And if God doesn't tell me to believe it, then I'm not supposed to believe it. If God says it's this way, then I'm supposed to believe that it's this way. If God said it's not this way, then I'm not supposed to believe this way. And the Psalm 118 says it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in men. Hey, isn't that what David found out? Remember when David numbered the armies and God gave him a choice? God said, you can either let man judge you, you can let me judge you. Now, with most people, I mean, that'd kind of make you afraid, right? Because God's bigger than men. But you know what David recognized? David recognized that men are wicked and they'll be mean to him, but God has mercy. Somebody say amen. So it is better to trust in the Lord than to put confidence in man. And I am standing here tonight. You're sitting here watching me. You're watching this video. You're saying, who in the world is Mike Hoggard? And why is he an authority over me? I'm not an authority over you. Not in any way, shape, or form. And I do not speak with a voice of authority. I'm going to let God speak for himself. Because if he can't tell you, then who am I? Right? I'm going to show you that the Bible teaches, number one, inspiration, number two, preservation, and number three, translation. Let's walk down this road. All scripture is given by what? Inspiration of God. It means God breathed it. Theopneustos, the original Greek. God breathed the very words that those disciples, that those prophets wrote. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. So what that means is that where the word is, the breath of the Holy Spirit also breathes life into it. Amen? And I have put my words in my mouth. This is the transmission process. And I have covered thee in the shadow of mine hand, that I may plant the heavens. Notice that God said, I've put my words in thy mouth. My words, thy mouth, is the doctrine of inspiration. Jeremiah, then the Lord put forth his hand and touched my mouth. And the Lord said unto me, behold, I have put my words in thy mouth. So it's not Jeremiah's words, is it? It's God's words. That's inspiration, the method of transmission. Now, let me give you a typical doctrinal faith statement that says we believe the scriptures to be the inspired, inerrant word of God in the original manuscripts. Now, let me tell you that I believe this statement as we're dealing with it right now. I believe that when Jeremiah took that pen and he wrote on that papyri what God had told him to write, that was the inspired word of God. Do you believe that? Say amen. It was it was good for them people back then, wasn't it? It was inspired. So as this statement currently stands right now, I believe that the original manuscripts were the inspired word of God. Now, but it doesn't stop there. We must deal with preservation. Psalm 12. Here again, I'm going to let God talk. The words of the Lord are pure words, as silver tried in a furnace of earth, purified seven times. Thou shalt keep them, O Lord. Thou shalt preserve them from this generation forever. God is teaching us the doctrine of preservation. For verily I say unto you, till heaven and earth pass, one jot or one tittle shall in no wise pass from the law till all be fulfilled. That's what God said, right? Jesus said it. He said it wouldn't pass till it's all fulfilled. Heaven and earth shall pass away, but my words shall not pass away. That is the doctrine of preservation. Amen? All scripture, and I pointed this out a while ago, all scripture not was given, but is given by inspiration of God. Present tense. It was present tense in Moses' day. It was present tense in Paul's day. And it's present tense in Mike Hoggard's day. The scripture is still given by inspiration of God. And you know that word given? That's a gift word in the Bible, isn't it? Do you believe that the Bible is a gift of the Spirit of God? I do. I really do. I believe. In fact, I didn't earn this. I didn't earn the words of life that Peter talked about. I don't deserve it. I don't have it coming. Amen? You agree with me? Amen? You don't know me, but you ought to agree with me. I'm telling you, I don't deserve this book. God gave it to me as a gift. The gift of His Holy Spirit. I'm going to show you from the Scriptures itself that this Bible is a gift of the Spirit of God. You're going to like this. So that's the doctrine of preservation. Now let's go back to this statement we looked at. We believe the Scriptures to be the inspired, inerrant Word of God and the original manuscripts. Now, you will find this. In fact, if you go to websites or you will call colleges, Christian ministries, organizations, churches, denominations, and ask for a copy of their faith statement, almost without fail, they will have almost the identical wording in that they say, we believe the Bible is the inspired Word of God and the original manuscripts, and then they put a period there. But you see, what they're not telling you is that in our colleges, in our denominations, in our Christian leadership ministries, radio ministries, TV ministries, book ministries, you name it, Christian youth organizations, they say we believe the Bible is the inspired Word of God in the original manuscripts, but we don't have any original manuscripts. And we believe that errors have crept into the manuscripts, the copies since then. So right now we really don't have the inerrant Word of God. And they have no scriptural evidence to support the statement. So you remember the idea that if God said it's this way and man said it's this way and man contradicted God, who's right? God is right. Let God be true and every man a liar. And I've been in discussions, debates, heated arguments with preachers and people who will say, you know, Mike, the Bible does have mistakes in it. It's got errors in it. It's got all this. There are verses that are not translated right. It's wrong here. It's wrong there. We have evidence. We have manuscript evidence that says that there's mistakes in it. But I've never had anybody show me one verse in the Bible and give me any indication where God ever said that His Word would ever corrupt in one small way. Nobody's ever shown me the verse. In fact, you can't. You can't show me the verse in the Bible that says the Bible's got a mistake in it. You know what I can show you? Turn to 1 Peter chapter 2. They'll say, you know what? The renderings between 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, that there are passages in there that don't agree with each other, and that proves that there are mistakes in the Bible. You know what? There are no mistakes. Let me give you something. You might want to write this down. This will help you, all right? Rule number one, there are no mistakes in the Bible. Rule number two, if you think you found one, refer to rule number one. All right? Because I'm going to show you why there are not mistakes in the Bible. There are mistakes in your mind. There's not mistakes in the Bible doctrine. There's mistakes in our doctrine. You know what? I don't think I've got it all right as far as my doctrine. In fact, I'm probably wrong somewhere. Probably some of you'd sit there and tell me where I'm wrong, right? But you know what? This Bible's right. Let me tell you what God did. In 1 Peter chapter 2, the Bible says, in verse 6, wherefore also it is contained in Scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief corner stone, elect, precious, and he that believeth on him shall not be confounded. Notice that Peter is saying here that if you just believe Jesus, you'll never really be confused. Unto you, therefore, which believe, he's precious. You know what I believe? I believe this Bible's precious. Listen, I could tell you the testimony of Mike Harger, but I'm telling you, this book saved my life, literally. It's precious to me. But unto them which be disobedient, the stone which the builders disallowed, the same is made the head of the corner, and a stone of stumbling, and a rock of offense, even to them which stumble at the word. So you know what you will probably find if you look hard enough? You'll probably find two verses that look like they're saying the same thing, but there's differences between them, and you'll say, you know what, that proves there's mistakes in the Bible. And you know what I say to you? If you go to the Bible looking for mistakes, God will let you see some that you think are mistakes, because you'll be like Israel. Israel couldn't see the Messiah because Jesus was standing in the way. And you know what people, you know what our theologians and our Bible colleges and our preachers are doing now? They can't see the Word of God because the Bible's standing in their way. And they have tripped and been offended over the very book that God said is the Word of God. They're called stumbling stone verses. So rule number one, no mistakes in the Bible. Rule number two, if you think you found one, refer to rule number one. Here's what they say. Well-trained textual critics operating on the... And boy, this sounds real good. Well-trained textual critics operating on the basis of sound methodology are able to rectify almost all misunderstandings that might result from manuscript error. Sounds good, doesn't it? But, you know, that almost all just doesn't quite cut it with me. And number one, who are the well-trained textual critics and why are they criticizing the Bible to begin with? And number two, what is the sound methodology? Isaiah 29:11, and the vision of all is become unto you as the words of a book that is sealed, which men deliver to one that is learned, saying, read this, I pray thee, and he saith, I cannot, for it is sealed. That's what's coming out of our Bible colleges. You can't really understand the Bible, so don't even bother. Let me tell you about these original manuscripts. You know what these original manuscripts were written on? By and large, they were written on a thing called papyrus. And I understand a little bit about that. It was a grass-like plant that grew in layers, and they would take it and split it apart and weave it together and all that stuff. And actually, the word papyrus is where we get the word paper from, okay? So they were writing, and you know, I've had this Bible now for a few years, and kind of like yours, the pages are starting to get worn on it, right? But you know, just because my pages rip and they get dirty and cruddy and ripped, and sometimes I lose one every now and then, that doesn't negate the effect of the Word of God. It's still there. Amen. So most of these were written on papyrus, and papyrus is grass, right? Notice what God said. The grass withereth, the flower fadeth, but the Word of our God shall stand forever. So you know what? God never one time promised that the original manuscripts would be preserved forever, because they're written on grass. And he said, grass will fade away. So I'm telling you, God was not interested in preserving manuscripts. He preserved his word. And the word still stands, even though the originals are no longer there. And I want you to notice that flowers fade too, don't they? So you know what's coming out of most of our ministries and most of our Bible colleges is that they believe in a Bible that has faded away. And the Bible says, woe to the crown of pride, to the drunkards of Ephraim, whose glorious beauty is a what? Fading flower. You'll see them get up behind the pulpits and the lecterns and they say, oh, praise God, we believe that I believe the inerrant word of God, but we don't have it in our hands now. That's what they're saying. And then thirdly, I believe in translation, and I believe it according to the word of God. I believe that the Bible was translated correctly, and I'm going to prove it to you. And I hear this from people all the time. No translation is inspired, only the original languages. Again, nobody has ever shown me one verse to support the fact that the Bible cannot be translated perfectly. Nobody's ever shown me that. Not one verse. In fact, I'm going to show you verses that will teach you otherwise. God said in Isaiah 28:11, for with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak to this people. So you know what God said? God said that he would speak in another language. A tongue is a language, isn't it? God said that he would speak in another tongue. In 1 Corinthians, Paul is quoting that, and notice what he says. In the law it is written, with men of other tongues and other lips will I speak unto this people. So God said, according to these two witnesses, that he would speak in other languages. Do you believe that? Say amen. So the partial fulfillment of that was in Acts chapter 2 on the day of Pentecost. They were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak in other tongues as what? The Spirit gave them utterance. So you know what those men were doing? Philip and all these other guys, they walked out there and they began to preach Joel. Peter said, this is that. And they were preaching the word of God, not in the original Hebrew. They were preaching, if you count them, there's 17 different languages that they were preaching the word of God in. And who gave them the utterance? The Holy Ghost did. And those men standing there, they said, how hear we every man in our own tongue wherein we were born? Those people there were the recipients of God translating the Bible. They got saved because God translated the Bible. You know what? I got saved because God translated the Bible. Did you? Somebody say amen. Now watch this. The word translation, we use that word to mean the go-between from one language to another. But the Bible uses the word interpretation. Notice Genesis, and they knew not that Joseph understood them, for he spake unto them by a what? An interpreter. I'm going to look at this word interpret just so that you get it. And this is the writing that was written. Mene, mene, tekel, upharsin. This is the what? The interpretation of the thing. Daniel is translating the language. Daniel 5, the king cried aloud to bring in the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers. And the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, whosoever shall read this writing and show me the what? The interpretation shall be clothed with scarlet. Behold, a virgin shall be with child, and they shall bring forth a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which is being interpreted, God with us. Notice that God is giving you the interpretation of what Emmanuel means. Emmanuel is a language that you and I do not understand. It's Hebrew. We don't speak Hebrew. And yet God is saying, I'm going to translate it for you and tell you what it means. Talita kumi, which is being interpreted. Damsel, notice the use of the word going from one language to the next. And they bring him unto the place Golgotha, which is being interpreted, the place of the skull. Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani, which is being interpreted. My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Then Jesus turned and saw them following and said unto them, what seek ye? And they said to him, Rabbi. And see, we don't use that. That's not an English word, is it? It's a Hebrew word, but it's being interpreted, master. So do you now know a Hebrew word? Because it was interpreted for you. And who interpreted it? God did. John 1:41, who he first findeth his own brother Simon and said unto him, we have found the Messiah, which is being interpreted, the Christ. And he brought unto him Jesus. And when Jesus beheld him, he said, thou art Simon, the son of Jonah. Thou shalt be called Cephas, which is by interpretation, a stone. I know I'm laying out a lot of evidence for you, but I want you to get this. Siloam, which is by interpretation, sent. So when the Bible uses the word interpret, it means going from one language to another. Now remember what the gifts of the Spirit are. To another, the working of miracles. To another, prophecy. To another, discerning of spirits. To another, divers kinds of tongues. To another, the interpretation of tongues. God is saying that it is, in fact, in spite of what all the theologians have told me, in spite of what of all my preacher friends have tried to tell me, that no translation, no interpretation of the Bible can be as good as the original. God said that it's actually a gift of the Spirit to be able to interpret from one language to another. Somebody say amen. In fact, I'm going to show you something else that'll just make the little doodads run up and down your spine. Because God actually laid down a formula of interpretation. And when an unknown tongue is given, watch this. 1 Corinthians 14. He said, I would that you all spake with tongues, but rather that you prophesied. For greater is he that prophesieth than he that speaketh with tongues. Except he what? Interpret. That the church may receive edifying. You know what he's talking about there? He's saying, if I were to get up here with an original manuscript in Hebrew and read it to you, are you going to get anything out of that? You know what doomed millions and millions of people to hell all during the dark ages was that the Roman Catholic Church stood there with their Latin Bible, reading the Word of God in Latin and not telling anybody what it meant. And people died and went to hell as a result of it, didn't they? Now watch this. Because God said, if any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or at the most three. Let me ask you a question. How many languages was the Bible originally written in? Hebrew, Aramaic, and Greek. What does this verse say? If any man speak in an unknown tongue, let it be by two or at the most three. And that by course. And then how many should interpret those three unknown languages? One. I think it's neat that God has taken three languages unknown to you and I, and I believe that they are interpreted in this one book. Do you believe that? Somebody say amen. I believe that. That God has chosen to take this old boy. I say I'm from Festus, Missouri, but I was born in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. Thank you, Pine Bluff. Thank you very much, all right? God's taken this old boy from Pine Bluff. And by the way, we left Arkansas before the Clintons got in, so that just... Okay, I had to throw that in there, okay? God took this old boy from Pine Bluff, Arkansas, speaks like this. And those three languages that I would have never known, God translated them into this Bible right here. And I read this and I got saved because I believed what God said. And it's a gift of His Holy Spirit. Knowing this first, that no prophecy of the Scripture is of any private what? Interpretation. And remember what Joseph said, do not interpretations belong to God? So if you tell me that my translation of the Bible is not the inspired Word of God, I'll tell you that the Bible says you're wrong and that the translation, the interpretation does belong to God. And they say, I do not believe that a translation can be inspired. And let me tell you something. If the breath of the Holy Ghost of God does not breathe through the book that you read, how can you be saved? Now I'm going to close this with this. I'd like for you to take your Bible, your King James Bible, and turn to Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53. There's something there that I want to share with you tonight. And oh, by the way, why the King James Bible? Because the Bible says in Ecclesiastes, where the word of a king is, there is power. Let me tell you something. This is the year 2004. Do you know what happened this year, 400 years ago? King James of England declared this in 1604, that a translation be made of the whole Bible as consonant as can be to the original Hebrew and Greek. This year celebrates the 400th anniversary of the proclamation by King James. And you know what? This verse is right. Where this book has been, there has been power. Amen? It was this book that built a nation and no other book. Let me teach you some things about the King James Bible. Number one, I hear people say that the King James is not copyrighted. Well, that's only partially true because the King James has what's called a royal copyright on it, in that anywhere that you go in the United Kingdom, the British monarch, King James, put his stamp upon this Bible so that it could never be changed. And why is that important? Because a few years ago, the sodomites over in England, they tried to sue Cambridge and Oxford University, who administered the rights of the King James. They tried to sue them to get the word sodomite out of the Bible because they said it made them look bad. No, their sin makes them look bad. Amen? Amen? And by the way, it didn't. You know what the courts ruled? The courts ruled that as long as a monarch sits on the throne in England, this Bible cannot be changed. Somebody say amen. So you know what? For 400 years, this Bible. Now, to give you something else. Now, I'm going to read a few verses out of here, and you read along with me. I have in my hand, it's a reprint of the original 1611 King James Bible. Brother Stan showed me out here on the front, you have an actual page of that original 1611 King James Bible. I've had people say, well, you say you believe in the King James. Well, which King James do you believe in? Because the 1611 Bible is not the same as the one we have now, because everybody knows it's been changed so many times. And the original 1611 Bible was written in what's called Middle English, and nobody speaks that anymore. In fact, you can't even read it and understand it. And you know what? I believed that for a long time until I picked up this 1611 King James Bible. And I want you to follow along with me as I read from Isaiah 53. This is 400 years old now. Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? For he shall grow up before him as a tender plant, and as a root out of a dry ground. He hath no form nor comeliness, and when we shall see him, there is no beauty that we should desire him. He is despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he hath borne our griefs. Oh, I love that, don't you? And carried our sorrows. Yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He is brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shearers is dumb, so he openeth not his mouth. He was taken from prison and from judgment. And who shall declare his generation? For he was cut off out of the land of the living. For the transgression of my people was he stricken. And he made his grave with the wicked, and with the rich in his death, because he had done no violence, neither was any deceit in his mouth. Yet it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He hath put him to grief. When thou shalt make his soul an offering for sin, he shall see his seed, he shall prolong his days, and the pleasure of the Lord shall prosper in his hand. He shall see the travail of his own soul, of his soul, and shall be satisfied. By his knowledge shall my righteous servant justify many, for he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore will I divide him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he hath poured out his soul unto death, and he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bare the sin of many, and made intercession for the transgressors. Is that what your Bible says, word for word? So you know what? It's not true. This Bible hasn't changed in 400 years. Now, there has been some revisions of the text. There are spelling errors in here, tremendous spelling errors in here. There are words that, and like in one place it says God and it should be good, or it says good and should it be God, something like that. And those are printing errors. But by and large, this Bible, and you know what? In a world of constant change, I go to bed at night with knowledge, knowing that if God said he never changed, he never changes. Is that what you believe in? Somebody say amen. Thank you so much. God bless you.